Welcome everybody to you're live on the web for day three of the 6 days of Amsterdam. Looking forward to it. You're in the right place. The action will begin live in just under 20 minutes time when the Medicine Masters get out there for 90 laps with 9 sprints. It's just the start of what will be a fabulous evening. Me, Carlton Kirby, and of course, Tony Doyle. We will be with you live then in just a wee while. Time for a cup of tea and a cracker. See you in a minute.
Thank you.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, an inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
was a great evening to be in Amsterdam to watch six-day racing. Leif Lampater and Raymond Kreder now lead the overall by one lap on all their rivals. The final Madison, however, went to Pim Littgaard and Marcel Katz, who won in a sprint and welcomed the extra points and lap.
Yeah, we're a little bit short in points, so we need to take the laps, and it was good to take one lap back. And now we can really focus on the podium and the next couple of chases, yeah.
Exactly. Now, who are your most important rivals for the next 4 days?
It's going to be the Belgium team. They're really good, and I think Leif and Raymond are doing okay as well, so it's going to be tough this week.
So how do you celebrate the Madison win? Is it, do you have beers or do you go to bed early?
I go to bed. It's still 4 days to go, so yeah, let's take it easy.
Day three won't be easy with Lampater and Kreder in a strong one-lap lead. Littgaard, Kaltz, and the rest of the competition will have to race all out to make up their disadvantage.
Are these love letters, Kenny, that you write to each other?
Not really. No, we've got a fan from Belgium, Anne, and yeah. she's actually a big fan of our team, our professional team, and. She's in a wheelchair, and whenever she sees the time and everything goes okay with her health, she comes in and supports us, and she makes this little riders, paints them, and she's also into drawings. This is apparently a drawing of me winning the Dernie Heat the first day. So yeah, it's a nice motivation.
And what's her name?
Anne.
Okay.
Yep.
And does Heiss have as many fans as Kenny, or who's more popular with the girls?
I don't know. Maybe we each got a mail from her, so yeah. We're at the same level now. But yeah, the 6 days it was still okay with the girls.
For both of us, track was a little bit. A big, yeah, like a starter for our cycling career. We both do track already from when we were young. I'm like 7 or 8 years older than he is. But we both had in the youth. We both did a lot of track racing, and we just kept doing it. And Hees decided to go more for road. I think he has more abilities than me on road, and I just focus really on the track and road. Is more as a preparation for me. Mm-hmm. So that's a bit where our roads split, but the way to our professional career went through the track for both of us, I think.
Here we are for the tip of the evening. Lampater and Kreder lead the race by one lap over their rivals. What do you know about them, and do they have enough to win the 6 days of Amsterdam?
I know especially Raymond Kreder very well. Lampater I also know, but more from that I see him racing. But Raymond Kreder, I know him from when he was 15, 16 years old, and he's a very smart rider, so he's perfect for the track. He's smart, he's fast, and that's everything to be a good rider on the track. And together with Lampater, they're very strong.
Everyone talks about De Ketel and Van Hook as the favorites for the 6 days of Amsterdam. Why is that?
Because they're the old world champions, and then it's normal that you're one of the favorites. But it's also more pressure when you're the favorite, because everybody's looking to you. You must do all the work, and now they're one lap behind. It's not so easy for them. They must take the lap back, and Kreder Lampater can control the race. So, they're one step in front of them.
Welcome to Amsterdam. This is how we stand. Lampeter and Kreder are our leaders. De Ketel and Van Hook, though, just 1 point off the magic 100 that will give them a lap back and put them back where they should be, up top. Well, I believe anyway. You are most welcome to the third night of the 6th and the opener of what is going to be a very busy winter season. And as you can see, the riders just warming themselves up on track as we speak. Tight track it is, just 200 meters, and it's been providing the thrills. No spills yet. so far during these 6 days, and that's the way we want to keep it. Clean racing, fabulous fun, and we will be underway before you know it. For our opening Madison, the Masters on, we will have the sprinters giving the Madison boys, who of course are the kings of the 6 days, their respite when they need it. It provides some sprinting fun and action throughout the night. And of course, if you are listening to my dulcet tones, then you are, of course, live streaming on the web, and you're extremely welcome. So my name's Carlton Kirby. Sitting alongside me is the magnificent Tony Doyle. He's well pressed out this morning. I can tell you he's looking dapper to the max, I think is how you say it in old speak, and when you're down with the kids as well. It's a fabulous atmosphere here. It's cauldron-like, isn't it? And the opening 2 days have been a joy. I'm expecting good things tonight.
So am I, Carlton. We've had a couple of days racing, been fantastic. And I think we're set to see a lot of action. It's very tight at the top. We see there's not a lot between those first four teams. Of course, the Kettler and Van Hock just need 1 point to gain a lapse bonification. So for each team that scores 100 points, they gain a lapse advantage on the rest of the field. So points are very precious, and there's a number of teams now who are very much in contention. Four teams who aren't that far away from gaining that one lapse bonus.
So our opening event for you, and more than looking forward to this, we have 90 laps. Let's just talk them through this. We have intermediate sprints. Early boys out of the box yesterday were the Americans, the Ireland 200 boys, Dan Holloway and Guy East. They decided, you know what, we need something out of this. We need to wave the flag, and that's precisely what they did. Nice to get them a modest victory, albeit in increments, out and underway. Just tracing some of the teams right now as they're still being introduced to the fans. Tristan Margay and Mark Hester, the Dane, Swiss-Danish partnership, they were looking extremely good yesterday and are kind of picking themselves up, I think it's fair to say. It's about retrieval right now and setting yourself up for what is the peak point of the 6 days. At the end of tonight, we are halfway, and that's going to mean a lot. I'm not saying it's going to be downhill all the way from here, but it gets more and more progressively difficult, and you need to have set your standard, not only marking yourself against the others, but for yourself. Really get it into your head exactly where you are, where you stand, and what you've got to do.
Well, that's right, and of course, track racing, 6 day racing, it's all about speed, it's all about explosiveness, but it's night after night, so day after day there's lots of racing to be done. So after 3-4 days you start to see a little bit of fatigue set in, and that's where the riders who have done the preparation have done a lot of road work, ridden a lot of stage races and kermesses and criteriums as part of their preparation to get ready for the winter. That's where it really starts to show, those last few days. That's where you see the stronger riders really coming to the fore and really asserting their authority over the rest of the field.
So we are waiting for the gun. It will be any moment now as they cross the start-finish line. And there we are. We are underway. 90 laps in total for our opening Madison Masters event. 9 sprints along the way. 5 points collected as a maximum on each of the sprints as they come. So with 90 laps, it's every 10 laps. It'll spin by before you know it. Average time for a lap when they're on full flight will be around about the 11-second mark. 5 points, 3, 2, and 1. So you score if you're in the top four. So we've got a lap counter on your screen right now, just at the bottom left, so you can keep in touch with where we are. But it is hand slings, and you're just seeing some modest ones going on right now that are a great character of this discipline, as you know, if you've been with us throughout the opening couple of days here. Well, this is day three. If you're just joining us, we are underway. 3 laps down, as you can see. Tony, it's always there's always somebody that reaches out at the very off to try and grab something early. Yesterday it was the Americans. Who do you fancy to take a step forward today?
I think we might well see the Americans go to the four early on in the race. Of course, the 90 lap Madison sprints every 10 laps. It's a great warm up for the riders, gives them a chance to sort of find their legs, but they're all chasing those points that are on offer. So Each sprint is 5, 3, 2 and 1 point for the first four across the line. And I think you'll see as this race unfolds, the string of riders, they will get faster and faster. The more warmed up, the more comfortable they get.
You know, we were talking earlier on today about how you've got to spin your legs into the discipline. If you're coming off the road after a long season, you're not used to going at this kind of cadence. There are subtle differences, not only in the event, the riding style, but also in the machinery. And it is vital that you can spin up to a decent pace. And the road boys generally tend to have left something behind on the road. You'll hear the bell when they cross the line next time round, so not this time. That'll be your first intermediate sprint, and then you'll get the hang of it. One man who really did get the hang of it throughout a magnificent career was, of course, Tony Doyle, sitting alongside me. Tony, a winner of 23 six-day disciplines. Could have been 24, should have been 24, if those naughty men at Grenoble had only given him that victory. We'll have more on that a little bit later. Right now, it's our opening sprint, and who's going to go for it? I'm not surprised at this at all. It's teams 12 and 13 heading for the line. Didier Kespers and Melvin Van Zyl, and it was Mel Van Zyl that crossed the line first. There he is. Now, the word is that the Czech boys of Hoffman and Hickey, they're in the green, team number 12 for We Publish, are being marked out by everybody, and so are tracks. Didier Kaspers and Melvin Van Zyl. Tracks a newly formed team, and it's almost like everybody in the pack just wants them to know that this is not going to be easy, they're not going to be given any favours, and they're going to have to work for it. And that's exactly what they did straight away here.
Well, that's right. I mean, there's no presents that are given in six-day racing. Everything's fiercely fought, and of course, it's all happening so quickly. The riders really have to concentrate, really have to focus, be aware of everything that's going on around them, because there's hand change, there's riders swinging up, there's riders attacking, so you've really got to concentrate, make sure you stay upright and you stay out of trouble.
Yeah, absolutely. What's nice to see right now is that just moving to the fore is Dan Holloway, the American. He and Guy East took the first sprint yesterday. I think they would have been hoping to be up there today, but seeing Hockman, Hickey, Kaspers and Van Zyl, so teams 12 and 13, they knew it wasn't worth wasting their energy, because those boys wanted to get something on the score sheet, and that's precisely what they've done. But Ireland 200 coming to the fore right now, and to my mind, they are going to be not exactly a shoo-in, but they're certainly going to be contesting this one. Also wanting to get on the board early, the Zeiss team, Wesley Crader and Nolan Hoffman. There we are. There's the points as they stand right now. These are intermediate points for this discipline. Once these are racked up by the end, so how you've got on in the intermediate sprints, you will then have your classification, and it's those points, the classification points, that count. So whatever you've scored on the intermediate sprints, if you've scored most of all, you will get 20 points to go towards your points tally. Don't also forget that it's all about distance. So if you lap the field, then you are in a happy place, because you are the leader. And guess what? Right now, Nolan Hoffman's decided to go off. And of course, Dan Holloway is on his case right now. Well, I'm not surprised to see some of the minor teams having a go, and the big boys are starting to join them as well. Vlasman comes to the fore. Thank you very much. He'll have some more of that. Wim Sturtinger, the Dutchman, setting his stall out. Watch those guys. Morris and Sturtinger mean business. They are fourth overall. And this bodes for a busy evening for the men in that multicoloured green, yellow, white, red and blue jersey.
Well, it certainly does. It shows they mean business. They seemed a lot more comfortable the second night. I think the first night, Jens Morris, who's the much more experienced track rider, much more experienced six-day rider, I think he was having trouble finding his track legs, finding it difficult to get used to the fast pedaling, and not quite finding the souplesse. But he seemed a lot better last night, and I think we'll see a lot more of them as the six-day unfolds. I think they're going to get stronger and stronger as the race goes on.
It's a point worth dwelling on. The souplesse, this is what we're talking about, the road guys. They're not used to spinning this quickly, are they?
No, they're not used to it. I mean, obviously, they're riding on multi-gear bikes, 22 gears, whereas the track guys are single fixed wheel. Most of them are riding a gear of 50-15, which is 90 inches. They're pedaling, really quick. I mean, average they're pedaling around 115, 120 revs. And of course, when they're really spinning out, they're pedaling 140 revs plus. So it's a different technique and it takes a lot of getting used to.
It does. You have a physiological memory of it as well. When your body's used to going that fast, it kind of seems normal. And you actually don't even consider it. It's not a question of thinking about how to make your legs spin quicker. You just do. And Jens Morris of Orica GreenEdge has found his pace. And look at that. Morrison Stottinger doing a fantastic job right now. Wim Stottinger, the big Dutchman it was, that took the line at that point. He's got 5 points. So have team 11 and 13, who have been busy early on. It is the bell next time by. Only 61 laps remaining. 90 sounded a lot, didn't it? Well, not at this pace. And away they go, and on the attack of the Telegraaf boys, and it is Roberts who's going to hand on to Aaron Gate. The Antipodeans in the mix for this one, you can be sure, but Boskamp, I think it is, that's going to come and take the line. Boskamp and Asselmans, and it was indeed Mel Boskamp from Meatec who hit that first. Good work.
Good work there by Boskamp, but it was the late change by team number 13. That's what cost them it. They changed going into that back straight banking. It was too late. They got the change all wrong there. They needed to change a lot earlier and then they wouldn't have lost out.
Yeah, if you actually change mid-banking as well, apart from anything else, if you're in a pack, a charging pack, it can work against you. It's different if you're out there TTing, but when you're in the mosh pit that is here, you generally tend on the sling to get thrown slightly up the banking, and it's not ideal. You want to be thrown into the final curve as opposed to during it. Anyway, we dwell, and that is how we stand at the moment. Kaspersen Van Zyl with 8 points. They've been a feature of a couple of sprints. They're doing well.
They certainly are, and they've set their stall out to make a mark in this event. It's interesting to see that a lot of the big teams, team number 4, team number 5, team number 1, they're just sitting back, using this as a perfect warm-up to get ready for the night's racing. They're not contesting the sprints now, and they'll be taking part, and they'll be dominating the action later.
Well, we're going to be talking to Nolan Hoffman probably in the next couple of days. He and Wes Crader, who's a local boy, man who took the Tour of Vendée last year, of course. The Zeiss team, they're wearing silver. Now, I'm not saying that they're not going to feature towards the end of this one, but they want to feature pretty early. And here comes Nolan Hoffman right now in the silver. He wants a piece of this, and he hits the front right now. That was good work. There was a lot of changes going on around him, and he's head off. He's going to try and get a lap on him. Oh, now will they give him a chance? Absolutely not. The chase is on, and guess who is chasing them down? It's the Dalen boys, De Ketelaere and Van Hoek, my choice for tonight. I think they want to be top of the mound by the time we reach the midway point at the end of this evening, so it'll be 3 days complete of the six. But Hoffman doing a great job. He went early, maybe a bit too early. Wes Crader making the change with him. We'll see how the men in silver feature at the end of this one, but already on the fight back, Kenny De Ketelaere and Gijs Van Hoek. Now don't forget, they're on 99 points coming into today, so it's not going to take much for them to feature high up the order when this one finishes, and in so doing, gain a lap back and get on the lead lap overall, which is what they need.
That's right. So they want to stay in contention. They're not too worried about this discipline, but they're never going to be far away from the action. And so just in case Team 10 there had any ideas of going away for the lap, they wanted to make sure that they got to the front and brought it back so that it was all to stay together.
You know, Nolan Hoffman has been absolutely superb, but check this out at the line. I think it may well have been, was it Gayton Roberts at the line? Didn't quite see it. I was off line there.
I think it was the world champion Aaron Gate, world Omnium champion. I think he just got that on the line.
Yeah, good for De Telegraaf in the bright yellow. I'm still talking about because I want one of those jerseys, frankly.
I know they're stretched lycra, Barton, but I'm not sure how much stretch they got in it. I mean, I was hoping to try one as well.
Yeah, well, you know, it could always be a glove puppet, I guess. That might be my only chance. Easton Holloway then are our leaders overall. Dan Holloway, I'm liking this. He and Guy East, strategy wise they perhaps haven't got it absolutely nailed down, but they're kind of waking up to the task, which is great. And the Island 200 boys, they know how to ride. They're not here as any kind of gift, or it's absolutely deserved. They got the 6 day contract. They're going to be enjoying. They're going to be a regular feature for us. Don't forget, we'll be live streaming as well for Rotterdam from the 2nd of January. So enjoy that. And you can see they are spinning down and spinning up a pace out there as well. And right now it's the tracks boys, Didier Casper and Van Zyl, who are still having a go. The most vocal boys out there are AA Drink, and Nick Stoffler apparently likes a bit of a chat, puts people in their box. I like that. Bit of frisson, as they say in France, and here's the bell. Oh, you want frisson? Did he go too early? I think he may well have been. Didier Casper is on a charge here for Team 13. 3 days at Bremen, 6 days, third in Bremen in the 6 days, I should say. Can he set his stall right now? AA Drink say no. Of course they do. Yes. No gifts in this game, and Yuri Hardvik took the 6 days of Tilburg along with Nick Stoppler. They believe that they can do something spectacular here over these 6 days. They're going for the overall win, and right now they're just breaking some hearts out there.
Well, you can see there was an injection of pace there. The riders, the string of riders, much more stretched out now, and so they really raised the tempo there. I mean, and when they were sprinting for that line there, you know, well in excess of 60 kilometres an hour.
No hanging around. Let's just talk before the next sprint about the difference between your standard road bike that these guys, some of these guys, would have switched on to come here, as Boskamp and Asselman are our leaders ahead of the Americans, East and Holloway. So the bikes.
Well, I mean, obviously, road bike, it's got 22 gears. The top guys there, that's what they're using at the moment. It's got brakes, but it's multi-geared, and it's built much more for comfort, whereas the 6 day bikes they're using, the track bikes, it's just a single fixed wheel with no brakes, so the only control you have is by easing back on the pedals, because you can't freewheel, you can't coast along, so you've really got to have your wits around you. But the bikes are built here for strength and for duration, and riding a 6 day is like a stage race on the boards. So the bike needs to be comfortable, to have a shallow seat angle, but it's got to be a steep head angle, because you've got to steer by leaning, because the geometry, the g-force in the banking, so a lot of the controlling of the bike is done by how you lean into the bike and out of the banking.
Yeah, it's bias steering. It's a strange one. We'll have some more on that for you in a moment. It will be the bell next time by. You can actually do offset steering as well, don't forget, because as you break the frame, you kind of turn. It's a strange one. You kind of pull your right hand down to turn left, because the frame breaks, you lean in and take it round. It becomes natural. It's something you're going to have to do if you get out there and test your own tracks. But this is great. Our overall leaders coming into tonight, the Beretti boys, Lapata and Crader, the men in orange, have they? They have not. And the reason is that the Dalen Heartbreakers from Belgium are really on form. De Ketteler and Van Hoek, I think, took the line there. We'll get a replay for you in a moment.
I think they just got it on the line. Let's wait until we see that photo finish. Very close, very tight, but I think they might have just edged it.
Terrific racing. It's been, you know, we expect some swings and roundabouts along the way, but this was a top sprint right now. Quality to the fore. Did he get it on the line?
Yeah, he just got it.
There we are. 27 laps remaining. It will be lap 20 where we get the next one. De Ketteler and Van Hoek have amassed 10 points so far. Easton Holloway are having an absolute dream, and we've got a breaker. They're going for the lap, and it's Margay and Hester that are heading out there. So far, they've got just about the back straight on everybody. Just slung into proceedings is Mark Hester, the Dane. Ninth in the national road race in Denmark, the 28-year-old. Sixth day of Copenhagen last year, they won. Well, are they going to mug the field? It's a good effort. Don't forget, if you get on the lead lap, you are the leader. It doesn't matter how many points have been amassed by everybody else.
That's right. I mean, Mark Hester's got a good lead here, over half a lap. Mark is one of the most experienced six-day riders on the circuit at the moment. He's ridden 68 6 days, won the 6 day of Copenhagen, and very experienced, and looks like it could be a decisive move.
Fantastic move, just off the back of the sprint. That's a perfect time to do it. Everyone's just resting up after having tested their legs, and they're going to make this absolutely superb. You'll see they'll just latch onto the coattails. There's the back of the pack. Got to make it there. The commissaires have to recognise that fact, and then so what sounds like a foghorn will go off. The pace is up out front, and yet again it's the Dalen boys that are setting it, team number four, and they're still not back on just yet. There's a lot of loose riders after the changeovers. They're just getting themselves clear, but a nice sling once again, and it's Mark Hester that picks that up. Still, they're holding him at bay because the bell's gone, the pace has gone up. So it's going to be hard for him to get on now. He may well get on after this next sprint. Round they come, and setting the stall out yet again to Telegraph. Luke Roberts wants it this time, and he's not going to be denied. Good boy. Still, we look further back. He hasn't made it back on. They all sit up, do they? No, the pace has been kept on. We've got four teams have gone off the front, possibly too many. Just distancing the Ireland 200 boys at the moment. Four then, can they make it away? And do they get back on Copeman's team number eight? Just about there, and having to zigzag from some spare riders just after the throws. Tristan Margay is nearly there. He's about 20 meters down, 15:10, and we'll have the foghorn in just a moment's time. There we go! Clear the decks, everybody. There's a super tanker coming through. Magnificent, good effort.
Tremendous effort. No, wasn't expected, but just shows it. It paid off. Mark has to use an experience to choose the right moment to go going soon after the sprint before. And they've gained that vital lap, which is going to lift them way up on the general classification.
There we are. They are our leaders. Confirmation. They have 5 points, but they have a lap. So behind them, a lap down, is De Ketel and Van Hoek, who have 12 points, but are a lap in arrears, courtesy of that magnificent move straight off the back of the sprint. Perfect timing as well. We've only got 14 laps remaining, which means two sprints left,
and it just means that there's not enough time for anyone else to go to try and gain that laps advantage.
Yeah, so it looks like we have our winners, Merguez and Hester, and everyone else is fighting for points. Points do mean prizes, especially when you get 100, you get a lap back, and so it is not going to be beyond the will of man to actually know that our boys sitting on 99, De Ketler and Van Hoek, will be our new leaders because of everything they've racked up, and the pace is up again and yet again. It's AA Drink boys. They're putting the hurt on out there, but look who's chasing them down. It's the Belgians wearing the number four. We're looking for second place. Don't get it. I think the Baretti boys came through, Lampeter and Crader, courtesy of. One more to come then. There will be no respite. The pace is going to stay high, and it's AA Drinkje who go for it yet again with Nick Stoppler and Yuri Harvik. They're having fun out there.
They certainly are. I mean, it just shows you how fast the pace is. Team number eight, who gained that lap, they're pinned on the back. They got into that place when they joined on the back of the string of riders. They haven't moved, so they find it really tough just trying to hang on. They've only got seven more laps to do. Let's hope they stay there.
We'll see. Margay and Hester, I think, have nailed this one. And there's no doubt about it, that was pure strategy at work. There was a decent pace about everybody as well. They found something extra, which bodes very, very well for them late on. Here is AA Drink then out front. I think the Telegraph boys want this. Gate and Roberts are running in fourth place. Easton Holloway have had a very, very good result so far. If they can hold on to this on the last sprint, they will get more points, which I am pleased about on their behalf. Nice sling as well has just happened amongst the Americans, the Ireland 200 boys. Four laps to go, and this is the business end of the day. Some late changes to be made. Points-wise, as we stand within this one, it is 5 points for Merguez and Hester. They're a lap ahead, so they will win this one. It's too late for anything else to change. There it is. Ketler and Van Hoek on 14. Stoppler and Harvik with Gate and Roberts both locked on 10. Lampeter and Crader, Easton Holloway, both on 9. So positions are going to be extremely important because there's only points down to 6th place. Come on, Easton Holloway. I just want them to get some more points on the board. Simple as that. Bell will happen next time by. Driving into the corner go Dalen, and it is Hayes van Hoek yet again who is spinning those Belgian legs up good and proper. Look at this, he takes the bell right now. Oh, and the AA Drinks boys, it's bragging rights at this time of the evening, and they've gone off like a bomb. I've got to tell you, Boskamp and Asselman behind them chasing him down. This is feisty stuff, and AA Drink doing a super job. That was a little bit of class on display late on here. Goodness me. Wow, Stoppler and Harvik can't help themselves. They've just got themselves some more points. Hester and Margay, though, are our victors of this one, getting that lap. Great strategy being displayed by everybody. It is, of course, a long game, this. Here's your final sprint home.
Yeah, final sprint. Team number five showed that they meant business, but that third place there by team number four, the Belgian boys, means that they're going to finish second overall in this Madison race, and they're going to gain 12 points. That's going to put them well over the magic 100 points. They're going to be on 111 points. They're going to be one lap up on the rest of the field.
Nice tweet in from Brian Travis saying, tell whoever you possibly can, everybody out there, this six-day racing online feed is absolutely amazing. Brian, you're in the gang. Margay and Hester taking it, doing a great job. De Ketteler and Van Hoek, 16 points. They boss the rest, so they pick up 12 out of this. 20 points will go to Margot and Hester. 12 points will go to De Ketteler and Van Hoek. Stoppler and Hardwick will pick up overall points totaling 10 after scoring 15 in this race. Boskamp and Asselman scored 11 here. They get 8 points. Lampeter and Crader, they get 6. And Gate and Roberts. Hey, Gate and Roberts, my boys. They got 4 more points. Good on them.
Great for them. That now puts team number 4, the Belgians, in front with 111 points. That's going to put Stoppler and Harvick on 99 points. So they only need one more point to gain their lap bonification as well, Carl.
Yeah, Gate and Roberts, the Antipodeans, Kiwi and Australian. Great to see him. Aaron Gate from Anpost, and of course Luke Roberts, known to many of you. He's Mr. Team Pursuit, I guess you might say. He's 3 times a world champion at exactly that. He is a dude. Team Pursuit, it might well sound like there's loads of individuals in there, but you've got to be an absolute master to actually hold that kind of thing together. Easton Holloway, what a shame, missed out on the points, finishing 7th after a good effort.
I mean, and you mentioned Luke Roberts there. Not only was he 3 times Team Pursuit champion, but of course Olympic gold medalist in 2004 in Athens when they beat the British team in the final. And they set a new world record then.
Yeah, but I was trying not to mention that.
Luke asked me to mention it. He said he'd give me a tinny.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. Break out the VBs. There you go. Handing out the flowers. That one was kind of stuffed down the barriers. Hope they haven't broken. Amsterdam today, we decided to head into town. Right now, we're going to head to... we'll have that story for you in a moment. Trackside, we're going to be having a chat with, I believe, our winners. Just getting them over and into position right now. And here we go.
We'll have him. We're here with Mark Hester and Tristan Marquet. Guys, how important was it to go solo and get that lap?
It's really important. We were not so lucky in the big chase yesterday, and yeah, we had to do something, and luckily the other guys were probably not warm enough for the first race, I don't know, but it was a good moment, and we used it.
And the communication with Tristan beforehand, what did you tell him before the race?
Well, we didn't really talk about it, but when a situation like this is coming in the race, then you have to react immediately, and yeah, we both know it, so luckily he was watching for me when I was attacking. That was good.
Super, thanks.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
Wow, that...
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
Welcome back. It is fun time. It's Kieran time. Absolutely. Hugo Hack, incidentally, is leading the Sprint Masters who are contesting this. And we are more than looking forward to this. One of my favourite disciplines, actually, Tony.
I mean, it's a great discipline, particularly when you've got 6 riders on a small track like this. And, of course, what we've seen the first couple of nights, we've seen some great racing, but there's been a lot of pushing and there's been a lot of shoving. I mean, there's no love lost between these Dutch boys.
I'm not complaining. No, I like a bit of a bit of the old skin swap. It is quite remarkable just how much they put into this. That's Bart Holmes. Bart's fifth on the first day, likewise on the second, so he's got ground to make up, the man in red. When you're looking at the business end, though, Matt Buckley, he featured, in fact, he took the first day and lost out completely yesterday, so the man in black's got a lot to make back up. Jeff Hoogland, he's a brute. It's great to see. He got barracked out of it on day one, but made amends, finished third yesterday in this one. We're looking right now at Hugo Haak. Him and Tony Mulder, not afraid to get into each other. And believe me, I suspect they may well do yet again. And don't forget, the journeys will be on hand before you know it, so you'll hear the buzz of the motorcycle. And it's taken a while. Everyone's waiting for the man himself. Tern Mulder, Olympic gold bronze in the Keirin. Now, he believes that this is his game and won't be tied to anyone who tries to make it otherwise. Matt Buckley in the black was the man who denied him on the opening day. Matt Buckley's only 20. Tern Mulder wasn't happy. And the man in the silver, I don't think we mentioned him, Nies van t Hunendaal, and he goes very well as well, but was fourth on both occasions. Here comes our journeyman. So he will pace them. The pace will gradually start to increase out there. If I had to guess today, I'm going to go for Jeff Hoogland in the orange, because he's an absolute beast, and he's at the back, which bodes well, because early on, it's a decent place to be. You've got a full view of everybody out there. You know what kind of pace they are. Locked out of it at the moment is Niels van der Hunendaal, and it may well be that they keep him out there. He's asking, do you want to come in? No, stay where you are, mate, which means he's going further round the track than anybody else. He's getting that extra couple of meters in every single lap, and he still can't find a space.
The journey in front is set a controlled pace, gradually lifts it up, lifts up the tempo and gradually accelerates, and he'll pull away and he'll have done a speed of 45k an hour. He'll swing off with 3.5 laps to go now. Interestingly, Carlton, Ron Szilard, who's on the front, the pacemaker on the journey, is riding on the golden journey.
Oh,
and it's 52 years old, that machine. Fantastic.
The golden journey. There it was at the top of the old beanstalk many years ago when he climbed up and took it back down.
Of course, his his famous father, Joep Szilard, is the bike that he used to use for many, many years.
Bless his pants. Fantastic. The incongruous riding position of the journey rider is to give maximum wind protection. It's not anything medical that means he rides like that. when you saw that Niels van der Hunendaal, he asked everybody if he could come in, and they all said no, so he's at the back. It's not a bad place to be, however, and Jeff Hoogland is just ahead of him. Tune Mulder in the white, at the moment in P4. Ahead of him in the black is Matthias Buckley, and then you've got Bart Holmes, the 19-year-old Bart Holmes. What have you got? Well, we're going to find out. With 3.5 laps to go, don't forget, the journey will pull off. He'll be given the sign by the commissaires, tight on the start-finish line. They'll tell him when he's how many laps he's got to go. Is there going to be a hand up from the men in the suits with the clipboards?
Yeah,
and he goes.
There he goes. 3 laps to go. He's out of the way.
He's gone, and so has Bart Holmes, who goes for an early one, and Mr. Silver, who couldn't, that nobody was letting him in the side gate, he goes for it as well, comes from the very back, and up into second place. You know, it's going to be the bell next time by, and Bart Holmes has gone very, very early, the 19-year-old. Maybe they didn't give him enough respect. He's got about 30 metres, 40 metres, something like that. Niels van der Hunendaal is on his case, but this is a very tight track. Don't forget, he might make this all the way. He smoked the field, has he? Final bend. I think he's going to hold on. The 19-year-old's going to make this. What about that? Oh, we like that.
Oh, fantastic. I mean, he went from a long way out, got everyone napping. The other riders looking at one another. We got that huge gap, and he wasn't going to give it away, was he?
Oh, 19 years of age and riding like he's been doing this for years. That was great. I don't think they gave him enough respect.
No, quite right. I don't think they did. And, you know, all credit to him for making the most of that opportunity.
That yelp of celebration started good and early. Wow, like that.
The young kid did good. He's the youngest rider out on the boards.
Oh, forget that for a start. Barton Holmes was the boy. That is a graphic to nowhere, I'm afraid.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
No, we didn't get a cue, did we?
No.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple. To make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
Look at that, he's only just finished his paper round and he comes here and he delivers.
All credit to him, and great for him to see. He's got a lot of friends and family with him here tonight, and he made the most of it. He's going to have some beautiful flowers there to give to his young girlfriend.
Oh goodness me. Away he goes.
What a happy bunny.
Yeah, very much so. I don't think he's ever had so many nice looking young ladies around him at one time. That's what success brings, my friends. Bart Holmes, genius. BQ Hacks, Neil Van Hoedendaal, Toon Mulder finishing in fourth place. He won't be happy about that. Matt Berkeley and Jeff Hoolan. You know what? That was a real mix up. Everyone panicked, and one man kept his cool, and there he is.
Yeah, now what a convincing win, though. I mean, tremendous for him. It's going to give him tremendous morale for the sprinted later on this evening, isn't it?
Every boost he gets, that was fantastic. Looked like he was on the afterburners there. That was superb. Thanks for your company. If you're with us on the internet watching the live streaming here, brief hello as well to Carly McCulloch, Olympic medalist from New South Wales. Great to see Carly, of course, doing her stuff at the Olympic Games in London last year. Kenny DeKettler is her beau, and he's here, and I reckon they're going to do very well indeed. Here he is right now, in fact, P2. This is the Team Eliminator. Would you like to explain?
This is the Team Elimination race, where the rider who's at the back of the race gets eliminated. The first rider will go out after 10 laps, so there's a while out before the first rider is eliminated. And then after that, there's going to be one rider who's eliminated every 5 laps, until they're down to 9 riders and they're swept for the line.
Got it? Good. So, it is a time of concern for you right now. We're going to see this one. It's the full elimination, and we'll see who is remnant at the end. So just to reiterate, this is in fact the full eliminator. So we will lose a team, whichever rider is active, you know, the way you have an active and a passive rider here. There's the gun. They've got 10 laps to set themselves in. After 10 laps, we will lose a team, and we will continue to lose another team every 5 laps thereafter until we've got 2 left, having a little sprint off.
That's right. We get down to the last 2 teams to sprint out between themselves to decide who's the winner. So it's a long, tough elimination race. Riders got 10 laps to get ready before the first teams are eliminated. So you don't want to get caught napping, hanging around at the back for far too long.
Yeah, it's about lifting up your petticoats. Or not. Here we go then. So you'll see the usual handovers, the usual slings through the through the curves, as you can see, and down the straight. In fact, here, it's hard even to talk about a straight because each curve just introduces itself to the next. There's virtually no flat on this course.
No, I mean, it's very short, so the straights are very short. You're spending more time in the bankings than you are in the straights. So a huge amount of G-force goes through the body. And when the guys, the riders, doing this night after night, it really gives the body a pounding.
Certainly does. So in five laps time, we're going to lose somebody. And so you look towards the rear and make sure you are not there. Now, we've seen a little bit of shenanigans going on here. Hester and Margay, number eight, they're at the back, and I think they're looking to be eliminated once more. Why? Because they're looking to set the track record right here in our next discipline, the time trial. The track record is 21.490. Jim Madsen and Marty Northstein hold that, but Hester and Merge want it. They went close on day one with a 21.528. Anyway, we'll come to that afterwards. But they're going to save their legs, I think, off the back of this. No disrespect to anybody, but I think team number eight, we're going to be waving farewell to them. They're plumb at the back at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, tactical move. They want to be eliminated early on. They've had a very hard fought win in the opening event, the team Madison over 90 laps. I think they're looking to have an early bath now, then go away, have a massage, and get ready for the two-lap time trial, where they'll be looking to really dominate and get a third win in 3 days.
They might look like they're making a bit of an effort here, but look at that. That's a sort of a faux shoulder rocket. Oh, job done. Oh, do you like the little shake of the head, like, never mind. Oh, dear. My little boy does that. When he's looking for favours. Yeah, I think a bit of kinology going on. Used to get an awful lot more of that in the old days of 6 days, but it's all very, very straightforward right now. They're saving themselves. They'll be going for that time trial. I'm looking forward to it. See how they go.
And so am I. I mean, they're very motivated, and they're delighted with how they've gone so far. But speaking with Mark Hester, the start of the week, they're after that track record for the two laps.
They are, and we'll see whether they get it. They've managed a 21.528 for the two laps combined. You'll see, it'll be our next discipline. So they're resting up right now in the hope of being in good shape exactly for that. So it gets serious right now. Everyone else here does not want to be eliminated, believe me. And Nolan Hoffman has to go very, very high in the silver jersey to stay in touch. The telegraph with the yellow jersey here at team number two. That's Aaron Gate and Luke Roberts, our Antipodeans. And they're trimmed. They're out.
I mean, very high up the bank, and there was just no room there for him. Nearly hit the fence.
There we are. He is done. So bye-bye the boys in the gold and black. I suppose that's appropriate, really, gold and black for Kiwis and New Zealanders. Never really thought about it. Anyway. It is the sponsorship of De Telegraaf, the local newspaper. Local newspaper? The national newspaper. Everything. So we have three laps to go until we lose another. Who's the candidate for you?
I think the team from America, Island 200, they're going to have to watch out there. Looks like they might get caught napping there.
There we are. A little shake of the head by Dan Holloway. He hands over to Guy East. It didn't look like the most purposeful handover, I must say. Hoffman takes over right now. Nolan Hoffman, the South African. And because he's at the back, there's a lot of traffic in front of you. The rider's making their own changes, and so you have to fight to get through. He's done a good job. And actually, right now, he's pacing the Americans. And I think they've made it. And going out, look to me like Barry Marcus and Rob Bartko from Bredenoord in the red, Team 7. And indeed, that is it. So they're doing a decent job, and Island 200, Guy East and Dan Holloway failed to score points at the beginning of the evening, overall points I should say, despite the fact that they took intermediate sprint points along the way. They're doing a decent job. It's funny what we're saying about how certain teams are sort of targeted to instill a bit of respect, and the Czech boys, as well as the new tax team with Didi Kaspers and Mel Van Zyl, being shown the whip hand by the pack yesterday and allowed a modicum of success to them.
Yeah, I mean, each team had to earn their respect. Each individual rider They're competing against riders who've been riding on the boards for a very long time. And we just saw Robert Barco go out there now. He's the most experienced rider in this 6 day. He's ridden over 76 days and he's won 20 of them. He's one of the oldest states, 37 years old. We've got a team being eliminated this lap.
Oh, I think it may well this time be the Ireland 200s. And it is, they look like they're powering down as we speak. And they are, the Americans getting called. And so, we race on. This is a full eliminator, don't forget. Don't confuse it with the super sprint a little bit later on. We'll have those rules for you as that event reveals itself. But this is going all the way. And yet again, unfortunately, we have an erroneous graphic. No, no, my fault this time by. We're seeing the remaining teams who are still in this one. It's points at the line, don't forget, but the elimination begins throughout. Two laps to go. Playing a bit of catch-up right now is Team 13, Kaspers and Van Zyl. And that was Didier Kaspers, third at the Bremen 6 days this year. Earlier on, we're in the winter season now when the real 6 day has just come very much to the fore. Lights off, Tony Doyle, reincarnate. Oh, he's having to work very, very hard indeed, and I don't think he's going to make it back on here. Ooh, did he? Did he make it?
No, I didn't quite make it there. Just missed out. Team 13 will be eight out. We're now down to 18 left in the race. Oh.
Yeah, I'm just checking actually. Team 13 got on. And it was Team 9 that got the spill. Boskamp and Asselman are no more. 13 ride on. Absolutely left it so late though. So very late. But they're still here. And out go Team number 9. Which is Mel Boskamp, junior national champion in the Kirin. And Jesper Asselman, the Irish International Track GP scratch race winner from this year. The Irish International Track GP ever go along there?
No, I haven't heard of that one. Didn't get the opportunity to go and compete there.
There's a Guinness tent, but then again, there is even a post office. Belgos. Ooh, now, you know what? AA Drink have got some work to do here, and they know it. And suddenly they're having to put something into this one. Something perhaps that they hoped they wouldn't have to. Tight on the inside, cheeky move. Cheeky late move by Didier Kaspers, but he didn't make it this time.
Now they made a mistake there. The hand over the chain was just too late. That was coming out of the bank and going into the back straight. And didn't give him enough time to get back up to the group string of riders.
Blasman team of Jens Maurice and Wim Sturtinger. A lot of ambition here. They're a lap down overall coming into tonight. But in fourth place and with a really handy points tally. And they don't want to give any away. For some of the main contenders, every single event is important. And so, this is. I haven't really talked about the Visa boys. They've been sort of moderately quiet, really, by their own standards. Pim Dicht and Marcel Katz. They're busy right now, though, the men in white. And they've got to be. Hoffman and Wes Trader in the silver. Team number 10. Look like they might be onto a bit of hiding here because the pace is very, very high. Lapito and Crater got to be careful, tight on the inside. And it is farewell, I think. We'll have a look. Yeah, powering down. It is Team 10. And Nolan Hoffman, job done, particularly in this discipline, just for now. In fact, it was Wes Crater. There we are, six left. Teams 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 12.
So, and these six teams who are left, they will all score points.
They will, that's the crucial thing. Despite being at the back at the moment, Boisman have got what it takes, but look at the quality out front. AA Drinks just ahead of them. Then we have the wee published boys of Hoffman and Hecky. The great and the good, still trading on the old stories. Yep, and there we are. Nice throw, terrific throw by AA Drinks. They'll be back into this one, and they are at the back. Plasman's going to get cut out of this one, I'm afraid. That's not great. Good tactical work there by the AA boys, but I'm afraid to tell you that Jens Maurice maybe just still hasn't got those spinners going.
No, not quite. I think he's going to need a little bit more time on track. In fact, I might even get on the track with him tomorrow myself. I mean, I've got so enthusiastic watching this racing. Tomorrow I'm going to get on those boards and have a roll round myself. And I said to the Yans, I might be on the track. He said, I want to come along and see that for myself.
Well, let's hope we stay on the bike this time.
I'll do my best.
Round they come. You know, this is a good old feisty effort going on from We Publish. Jiří Hochman and Wojciech Hecky, they're pretty handy, and they're being paced at the moment, or just behind them, Dalen with the Keffler and Van Hope. There's the bell. They're going to be allowed to have this one by the looks of it. There we are. They can have one this time by. No points for the intermediate, don't forget. It's about who gets trimmed off the back. And right now we're looking at the Baretti boys, Lampeter and Crader, who came as leaders into tonight.
Team 5 there, they lost out by getting that change coming in at the wrong time. So they're eliminated. We're now down to 4 teams left on the track.
Well, they really did mess it up because I was distracted momentarily and I thought that it was the Baretti boys, but there we are, Airdrix it is. Baretti men in the orange still here, apologies. Well, they might well still be here. There's 2 laps to go before we have our next eliminator. So the points are being handed out right now, and it's Team 1, the Visa boys, Lichtart and Kautz, who are at the back. You've got to be absolutely attentive. The speed's here extraordinarily high.
I mean, it's fast constantly all the time. I mean, all the racing is done at 50 kilometres an hour plus, Carlton. Yeah. No hanging around.
No, and 5 laps just disappear almost in the blink of an eye. And here we go. Oh, and well, we said they were resting up, and the Visa boys are going to lift it up. Are they just at the very right time? And they do. And we publish. It was Jiří Hochman who gets the bullet. He and Hucky will take 8 points out of this. 3 teams remain then. Lichtart and Kautz, team number 1. The Kettler and Van Hoek, team 4. And Lampeter and Crader coming in as leaders to this start of this evening. Team number 6 in the orange. Here we go then. It'll be the bell. Next time, not this passage, next time on the line. Then we'll have 2 left and we may well see a bit of cat and mouse. Let's have a look. So who's going to get trimmed out of this one? Very, very late change and a tactical change late on as well. Just on the exit of that corner to start the final lap of this particular sprint trim. Oh, he didn't want to lose it, but he did. There we are, and Pim Lichtart sails up and out. So we have just 2 remaining here, and it slows right down. And that's because this effectively just turns into a standard sprint.
Standard sprint, 2 riders left. I'm not sure whether they're going to be changing with their partners or whether they're going to stay and contest it between themselves. It looks like the 2 on the track are going to be the ones going to fight it out. Calls 20 points on offer for the winner and 12 for the second.
Yeah, nice and relaxed. This is the run to the line, and so as a result, it just turns into a regular sprint between these 2, and they'll be weaving, you never know. I think we might see some track stands tonight, not particularly right now. I think they've got too much pace in them. As a look, oh, a little bit of weaving, shaking of the head. Well, I like it, but I've got to tell you, Kenny De Kettler doesn't. It's De Kettler against Ray Crader here. Crader in the orange, De Kettler in the pink. And there's the bell. Time to go, boys. And he does, he lights it up. De Kettler tries to pace it away and go long. Maybe that's the character of the evening. Ray Crader picks it up though, comes up right round the outside. Does he make it? I don't think he did. Well, he thinks so. You've got to trust him more than me. There he is. Well, terrific. Love the eliminator. It's very much a part of the track scene in the hearts of cycling fans everywhere. The boys in orange have delivered. They came as leaders, don't forget.
and they have taken the team eliminator.
They came as leaders, and those 20 points that they've scored, that's going to give them a lap bonification as well. So I think we'll have seen team 6 with a lap bonus, team 4 and team 5 Stoppel and Harvick. And I think you're going to have Lampazzo, who's going to be out in front now. One lap ahead of De Ketelaar and Van Hoek, who will have points lead of 123 points.
There we are. De Ketelaar and Van Hoek actually managed to get their lap back because of racking up more than 100 points, having been only one shy of that coming into here. However, Lampazzo and Kreider were on 89, and the points that they have amassed this evening also mean that they click back to zero. They are the leaders. I'm hoping we can get an overall graphic for you fairly shortly, just so that that's nailed down in your mind.
See,
yeah, the great, the good about to just head in with the flowers. Very well deserved wipe down. There'll be there is actually a refreshing area here. Freshening up area, that's what I mean. Of course, there's a massive refreshing area in the centre where you can get your beers and your wines and wine yourself and dine yourself while these boys do their stuff.
Looks like they're enjoying this presentation there. Hard earned win, but enjoying the moment. These team eliminations are really forcefully fought out, aren't they, Calvin? I mean, 20 points on offer, a lot at stake.
Yeah, very much so. It's
and that win will have put them back into the league.
Yes, Phil Appleby, Rad Wagon, Debbie Hill, Magnus Backstead, Guy East, Martin, thanks for your company. It's enjoying himself. Magnus asking if we're going to be doing the Madison before the track racing begins tomorrow. We're both going to have a go. One of us might be fibbing. Anyway, Maggie, thanks for your thoughts. Always good to hear from you. Glad that this is going far and wide. Maggie wishes you the best, but wants to see the pictures.
Well, I remember Maggie when he rode his one and only 6 day. He rode the 6 day of Rotterdam, and I think that's the only time he's ridden a 6 day, but he ended up and he was doing very well. I'm sure if he stuck at it, he could have become a serious and accomplished rider on the boards.
Has he still got time? You can tempt Magnus Baxter with this, but Magnus Baxter, incidentally, is an erstwhile colleague of ours. He's also happens to be a Paris-Roubaix winner. He is a Swedish god. He's probably blushing as we speak right now. But yeah, he's turned his hand to triathlon. Max, start spinning up and get yourself on the track, mate.
I think his wife Megan would prefer he turned his hand to DIY and did some of those jobs that she's waited 4 years around the house.
Stick the shelves up, Max, get on with it. Here we go. Time then for the, it'll be a two lap time this time trial. So it will be a double lap. You'll get the picture in just a few moments time. Rather conveniently, we have let the rolling clock stay on your screen. It will start rolling with two to go. The pace will be extremely high. You'll get a final throw, and then you'll have one rider going for the time that will be set for the team. Now, Hester and Marge, team number 8, they have been the quickest on two evenings, so wait for them. Right now you're looking at team 2, the Telegraaf, and this is Aaron Gate and Luke Roberts. It's our Antipodean boys, and right now it's the Kiwi Gate who's out front ahead of Aussie Roberts. So Roberts it will be that's going to be taking it. They hit the clock line, the time begins, and here we go. That was a little bit tardy there.
Very slow that, Jay.
That wasn't fantastic. Oh, 11 and a half seconds, you need to be looking at under 11 if you're going to make any big waves here, I'm afraid. So around the outside they'll come, but this is going to be 23s, I think, by the time he hits the line. Oh, well, all bar, look at that, 9,000. Shy of 23 mark, a 22.991.
Interesting to see there that they changed the tactics, and the first two nights you've had Luke Roberts who sat at the front and led them out.
Well, we'll try and get an amendment on that graphic just to bring it back into view for you in just a few moments time. But on course at the moment is Bredenord, Barry Marcus.
He'll be going last with Rob Bartko, who's pacing him at the moment. Rob Bartko is phenomenal at this sort of thing. 8 6-day wins. He's won here as well previously. 37 years of age, Rob Bartko. He's kind of the daddy of the place, really. And don't cross Bart.
He's a big rider, and in fact, he's actually won 26 days. And so, very experienced rider, former double Olympic champion, won the team pursuit and the individual pursuits at the Olympic Games in Sydney in 2000. And what a great man to have you leading you out.
There's your benchmark time as it stands. Quickest so far this evening at 22.991. It's about points and beating the benchmark time. That's been set by team number two. Right now then, wish them well, Barry Marcus and Rob Bartko, as the clock starts to roll. What have you got, fellas? Barry Marcus it is that gets the sling. Rob Bartko had been pacing him up until this moment. One lap done. Through it he comes, 11.4. Wasn't the biggest of slings, was it?
The sling wasn't bad, but Rob Bartko came into it too slow.
Plus the 23. Plum last right now, but a lot of teams still to come, but that wasn't spectacular. There you go. You can try and big them up, but they've got to step up as well.
They've got to deliver, haven't they?
You know, we're giving them a launch pad here. For goodness sake, light the touch paper, fellas. Next up, it's Ireland 200, Guy East and Dan Holloway. Come on. Twice a national champion in the Madison, Guy East. And he's here like he's got his party cake and he's eating it. Maybe he needs to cut down. Guy East lives in Tijuana, 26 years of age. Dan Holloway is the wise part of this pack. Dan, I've got a feeling, you know, that Dan's going to end up one day as a DS. He's got that way of just reviewing the situation. He's a great strategist. And right now it's Dan Holloway who is doing the pacing. Guy East the trailing right now. He'll hang an arm and he'll give him the slingshot. Clock begins right now. They're leaving this one a little bit late. Let's have a look. Nice! Okay, come on then. Guy East, what have you got? It's now or never, fella. This is the halfway mark for him. 11.581. Needs to pace this one really and just bury himself. Take it to another level. Gonna be 23s though, isn't it? There he comes, fading slightly. 23.287. Work to do.
The problem we had there was that he was riding far too high up the track. He was up above the red line. You've got to try and keep it as low as possible, trying to cover as short a distance as possible. So they had trouble there holding it down coming out of the bank.
Don't forget, any of you out there who've got any questions that you'd like to have us ask, then please feel free to do so. Kenny De Kettler loves us, apparently. And I'm not surprised. We're nice guys. Talk about boosting yourself. Carly McCullough, she's watching in from down under, along with a whole raft of Aussies and those of you in the Pacific Rim and everywhere else around the planet who've got the live streaming. Exceptional quality. You get it here, you'll get it in Rotterdam as well. We're going to try and nail down a few more for you too. It's magnificent. And if you love your six-day racing, then surely you're loving this. Out on track right now, it's Mel Boskamp and Jesper Asselman. They are team number nine in the black and white, the Panda crew. And here they come. Great work, nice pacing work as well. This is going to be a decent time. Yes, to Asselman is that is setting the mark at the moment. Running off will be Mel Boskamp. And there he goes. This looks better. Still a bit too much movement, but he's in a decent place. 11.2, but we've had some 11.4s, and he's going to be picking up more and more pace. Got to keep it down. Let's see how high he gets. Nice and low. That was a good drive. 22.687. It's our new best time so far.
I mean, a good time, but again, when they came in, the lead out, they came, left it too late to come down and hit that timing straight. When hit the timing straight, much nearer to the bottom of the track rather than high up the track. You've got to be at flat out speed by the time you cross the timing straight with two laps to go.
There you go. Watch out for Margay and Hester are going last. They've reversed the finishing order. They won yesterday. They went last, of course, yesterday, having taken the opening day with a time of 21.528. That was
500ths or thereabouts outside the track record, and that's what they're going for. That's why they stepped out of the elimination race and kind of faked disappointment about going out first of all. We'll see how Bergen has to go. Right now on track, you're looking at the tracks boys, Didier Kaspers and Melvin Van Zyl. These guys can motor, you know, when they need to, and not expecting them to be too tardy, although yesterday they had a complete mess up. It was a dreadful change. 23.5 they got yesterday. Come on fellas, let's have an improvement. And maybe they've been practicing. There goes the clock. It certainly looks like they mean business. I like this. Didier Kaspers setting it off. That's a better change. Now, how low can you go?
It's keeping it down the bottom. Oh, look, it's way above the red there, coming down the finishing straight. It's going to cost them time there, Carl.
It is. He's done it again on the back straight. So he's he might get a smoother entry in, but unfortunately it doesn't translate into time if you go further. 23.215, at least it beats their time from yesterday. And it's, in fact, that's the quickest they've gone. They need to work at it.
Yeah, they need to work at it. Just not getting it quite right. I mean, obviously they have got the experience, young guys, but that's something they need to work on, and they can improve drastically there.
Absolutely. So out on track, it's our breakfast buddy, Nolan Hoffman from South Africa. I think we're going to be having a chat with him and his teammate Wes Crader possibly tomorrow. Each day we select a team and find out just what's going on inside their heads. Wes Crader, local boy, and Nolan Hoffman has made the trip. They're really settling themselves in, not offering them any excuses. You've got to learn very quickly to work with your teammates, no matter who you're drawn with for the 6 days. And I think they're starting to settle into this one. Certainly Nolan Hoffman says he feels he's getting faster. Let's see, here we go.
Let's see how low he can keep it down. Wandering there.
Not bad, but 11.456, what's he got for the second phase here?
I mean, too high up again. He's got to keep it much lower, down on the bottom of the track. Needs to be on that black line or below it.
22.483.
I mean, a great time considering how much further up the banking they were going. So these guys can really move quick.
They can. Nolan Hoffman, he's well known in South Africa. He's a terrific pace man himself on occasion. He takes the applause and is the quickest so far. Crater and Hoffman. Now, that means that they're going to be in the points.
I mean, you know, all credit to them. Just shows that they can improve their technique, improve their style, get their changeover quicker, and most importantly, ride much lower down the banking, they could go a lot quicker, get close to that 22 magic 22 seconds.
I think so. Eighth on the opening day, they were seventh yesterday. They're now our leaders with four to go, so they're going to finish at least fifth. So they are having a lovely rolling improvement, Nolan Hoffman and Wes Crader. I like that. Like these guys too. Last one, it's Jens Maurice and Ben Sturtinger in that rather multicoloured outfit. Here we go. 22.483 is what they got to beat, set just a few moments ago by Hoffman and Crader. It's the time of the night so far.
That's see what they got. A good change there from Jens.
Oh, check this out. Almost down on the black. Fabulous. Sails round that curve. Using the banking brilliantly, staying as low as you can possibly go here. Phenomenal, this is going to be good. Oh, what about that? 22.231, our best time so far.
Yeah, I mean, he kept it very well there. Kept it right low there, below the black for a lot of the two laps effort there. And that was superb. Good to see.
Very much so. 22.231. And 0.2. A little bit more than that to the good. Next up, it's Ligtar and Kals. And in fact, it isn't. It's A.A. Brink, Stoppler and Alrik. Here we go. Now these guys, they are playing every card they possibly can. They're phenomenal talents, of course. A pair of them, they're just 22 years of age, so a combined total of 44.
So a couple of young men here, but with a great deal of determination. And as far as they're concerned, 6 days belongs to them. I like that kind of controlled arrogance. You can use that. And these guys, well, it's not unfounded. They've got a lot of talent. Let's see what they can do right now. Here they go. Bang, through the line, and the clock starts to roll for them. Nice change. Stay low and go. Past the sausage machine at the top end. Just gets a little bit high and wide, I'm afraid, on the straight. That's kind of lazily setting himself up for the corner and not wanting to take the G's. He's down there at the moment. What's he got? 22-231. What is he aiming for? Oh! All the twos! That's a third of a devil.
I mean, great time there, but I think they could have gone a lot quicker. They came down far too late. They were way up the top of the track when they came round to hit that time track with two laps to go. They'd have been lower, they could have even got under 22 there.
I think so too. And I think they will as this competition progresses. Don't forget, this is the halfway mark we will hit as we hit the buffers later on. Once these 3 days are complete, we are at the halfway stage. So we're driving to the peak. How's that?
I mean, you'll note, Carlton, that all the teams, all the riders are riding the aerodynamic solid disc wheel on the back, making it matter much quicker. They're riding a higher gearing than they would do for the Manifold, because they know it's all about a short, fast, flat-out effort. They're all searching and striving for those points.
Yeah, they got the old pizza tray out at the back. Here goes your clock next time by. They will light themselves up. You know, the shiny old bellman's doing a great job. Give it a polish. There it is. As we speak, got a speck of dust on it. Here we go. No flies on these guys either. Away they go, Hockman and Hockey. Team 12. Come on then. Into the curve they go, staying down low. Stay there, he does. In fact, he's below the black line. That's tidy, still tidy.
Poor change here, though. It's going to cost them.
Right, let's see how much. What price? Nearly 23, you know. You're absolutely right, Tony.
I think we've got just, what do we got? Three more teams left here now. Carlton, team number one on the track.
If they come, it's Nick Dart and Counts. Now, as far as their performance that they've been posting here over the last couple of days, they got a dreadful change yesterday, if I'm not mistaken. They've got a 22.799. They did a 22.5, near enough, 22.588 on day one. So let's see how they progress. There's your target, all the twos.
I think team one, they're going to be under 22.5 today. I think they're going to be challenged for that lead position, that 22.22.
Well, I think you might be right. They haven't quite got the pace they'd be hoping for right now. When they really are looking determined, they seem to have a bit more of that. Let's see as they go at the top end. Right, this is the important bit. See, they're heading this a bit late for me. Well, there you go. Clock underway right now, deep down. It's all about the change. Come on!
High up on the track, got to be lower.
11:21.5, and he's blown it. He sat up, not happy. Well, there we are. Something has he had a technical?
I think it's a mechanical.
Yeah, I'm actually looking. He's not punctured, is he? Let's have a quick look at the back end. Not happy anyway. So unfortunately, that's not great. There we are. Bailed out. It goes on though. And listen to this. The Belgians have decided to make the trip. And I'm pleased for them. Here we are. It's the Dalen boys. Kenny de Kettler. Charlie McCulloch sitting up at home down under in New South Wales and screaming at the television screen. I'm not surprised. The Belgian Mafia in the house. Kenny and Heist. Here they go. What do you got? Will it be a heist? We'll see. They've got the weaponry. Round the top end they come. Not a bit of pace about them right now, but they've got it right now. Here we go. Now, this looks good. Clock will roll when they cross that line next time by. Transferring him on.
It's the Belgians that are my pick for the night to come out on top. And here we are, they mean business. That's proper, really is. Bang, underway. Here goes the clock, down low. What's your change? What do you got, fellas? That looked tasty. Slinged into the corner, just a little bit high on the entry. Keeps it low on the exit. Here's your first phase. Oh, look at that. 10-9-35 of the Clarence Grove Blakely. And I'm not surprised. If he can deliver this one, we're going to be into the 21s. That is for sure. Come on, there's the line. Oh, just over the 22s. But it's the time of the night so far. They punch the air.
Tremendous. What a lead out there by Kenny. Tremendous. He really wound it up very quickly, but I still think he needs to hit that time street lower down the banking. But they've taken the lead and just got two teams left, and who's going to be the team that's going to get under 22 seconds tonight?
I'll tell you, it's Marge and Hester. They'll be going last, but right now it is the Beretti boys in the orange. Leif Lapidus and Ray Crader. Now these guys can turn it on when they need to. The German Lapidus with the payload of the two numbers, so he's the man who's setting the pace at the moment. Regular 6 days, got six wins to his name. Way back, Rotterdam, 08, with Danny Stamm. Remember Danny? Yeah, he took victory there, and that's a big scalp to take. Just ask the man who's sitting next to me, Tony Doyle. Olympic Game team pursuitist as well, fourth in Athens. Wasn't a smiley face that day, I'm afraid. Lost out in that battle for bronze. Forget about that, it's about now. There's the bell, round the top they come, decent pace about them as well. Here we go, full attack mode, is it? This the front up.
Lower down the track there, so much better. And can he keep it down on the black line? Can he keep it low? Oh, it's wandered up onto the red there, coming to the home straight.
You perfectionist, 11 flat it is. Can he pick it up in the last phase? Here's the line beckoning right now. Count him home, everybody. 22-190 is target. Oh, you know, they did it.
Just did it. So they've now taken the lead. We've got one more team to go. Team number 8, and they won the opening two nights. Oh, they're going to be under 22 again. I know they're after that track record of 21-4.
Now watch this phase out. Opening phase right now, they're spinning themselves in, getting the mind together. Focus is what you got right now, but already, as they sail by our commentary position, I can tell you they have got a bit of a pace about them. Still in relaxed mode, and we've got three laps to go before this is all over and done with. They opted out, essentially, the elimination race. You just wait for that bell. When it comes, these guys are going to be rocking. Past as they sail right now. Absolutely magnificent. They look perfect for now.
They really do. I mean, look how fast he's coming into that home straight now. He's really lifting Mark Hester.
Perfect drive.
Look how low he comes down.
Terrific attack. And he gets so much drive on there. There's the change. Lovely handover. Now stay low as you can go. This is the first one. 10-8-0-8. This is magnificent. The crowd know it as well. Plenty of them on their feet. A little bit high as he comes into the final curve. I still think they're going to get under the 21s here. Here we go. Hey! 21-6-83. Goodness me. That's quicker than yesterday, but not as quick as their first day. They want 21-4-89 is their target to take the lap record. They didn't get it. Still got three nights.
Still got three nights, and I think they're going to change that lap record here, a track record, but nearly half a second quicker than anyone else. So three nights, they've won three nights in succession. And so they've shown that they really do mean business in these timed events.
They are the daddy when it comes to this two-lap time trial. Enjoying it. Hope you are at home as well. It's a joy to have you company here on the 6 days. As you change, that was the part that they lost it to.
I think so. They went a little bit higher there, but they've been experimenting using different equipment, trying different gearing, and tonight they were using 15-14, so a gear of 96 inches, and it certainly paid off.
Neil Warner's written it on Twitter. If you'd like to join the conversation, by the way, it's Carlton Kirby, at Carlton Kirby. And he says, you're spoiling us. This coverage is fantastic. He's absolutely right. Neil, you're in the gang as well.
We see here, team number 1, they had that mechanical. It was indeed a slow puncher. the commis says the jury have been very kind to them. They've given them a second chance to have another attack at this to see if they can score some valuable points. The last team on the track now. There's coming at it for the second time.
And there's their target. That's a tall order, isn't it? I don't think they're going to beat 21.683. That said, Pim Ligdahl can really send in the revs. It's quite remarkable. Right now it's Marcel Katz that is out there at the front. Ligdahl yesterday actually left a mark on the track, and it was a drive mark, it wasn't a slide. He was putting so much power through the back wheel, he left a strike. Here he goes, what can he do this time by? Clock already rolling, and Pim's on the march right now. That is very good at 11.049. He could well get into or underneath the 22s here, into the 21s once more. I hope he does. This will be fantastic. Oh, just outside 22.180. Very, very good indeed. Good enough for third place. I'm glad they let them roll once more.
Quite right. I mean, they managed to get themselves back together. It's always very tough after you've gone out, you've psyched yourself up to have an attack on a two-lap time trial, and then to find that you've got a mechanical. But all credit to them, they came back, they got themselves got the bike sorted out, and they came back out and they got into third place. So a great ride for them there, and they showed that they're going to be major contenders in this 6 day come Saturday night.
Terrific. We will have a brief chat in just a few moments' time with, I presume, our winners. What a phenomenal record they've got in this discipline on the 6 days. Nobody can get close, it seems.
No, it seems that they've set the benchmark, and they're making this event, making it their own. And I know that they are determined. I was speaking with Mark early this morning, and he wants that record come the end of the week. Wants a track record.
Well, I hope they get it, but it becomes more difficult. I think today was possibly their best chance, although on day one, when they were freshest, they went fastest. And it does wear you, this competition. And they're competing in every round, let's not forget. So it may well just be slipping from their grasp. I'm not sure.
Well, I think tomorrow night we're going to see them go even quicker. I think they're going to go the fastest they've gone here.
I think tomorrow's the night where they'll go as fast as they can do, because then this competition, this 6 days, is going to start to wear them down. We were talking about this earlier, Tony. The deeper you get into a 6 day event, that's when the quality starts to tell between those who are capable of making it all the way and those who, not ill prepared, but those who kind of get found out form wise. It starts to show, doesn't it?
It certainly does. It's all about rest and recovery. It's trying to make sure that you're able to relax off the bike, try and make sure you get as much sleep as possible so that you give your body a chance to recover for the next night. And of course, it's all about having massage and using that massage to give you a chance for the muscles to relax.
Yeah, my watchword. Let's get outside with Graham.
Okay, guys, what makes the time trial your event?
We are two fast riders, and I think we have the right setup to make a high speed in the beginning, and Tristan is fast at the last lap, so it's perfect.
The crowd's yelling, going wild tonight. Do you feel their support out there on the track?
Yeah, for sure. It's fantastic. I would like to see even more people here. I think if we have the hall full, then it makes also possibility to do a faster time. And I mean, we are really close for the record. So with more people, I think there's a chance we can do it.
Thank you. Second time we've seen
in it tonight, but it's a question of maintenance. Can he get under the 22s like they did last night? Of course they can! 21.684! Oh, what about that?
Fantastic, fantastic.
One more corner to come, go wide round the outside. Luke Robertson, is he going to get this? Oh, and they do!
What a
beautiful
fantastic
work! Fantastic! Who's going to make it to the line? This is a crucial one. This is for second place. Oh, but taking the event and punching the air goes Pimlik Das. Team one. It is on the lead lap. Yes, Flassman crossed the line first, but was trying to get back onto the tail end. The leaders out there were teams one and six. And that is delivery. Here's the race for the line.
I mean, what a race that team one did.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
Welcome back. The buzz tells you the Derny racing is underway. Each team picks a rider to be involved, and as there are 13 teams, they have to split the field. First phase of the competition, which carries its own points, 5, 4, 3, 2 and 1. In reverse order are the points that are achievable, and we have six riders at the moment being paced by the drivers, as we call them, on the Dernies. Just so there's no confusion when we say riders, you know it's the cyclists as opposed to the motorcyclists. So a Derny driver along with their chosen riders. It's by lot, so no choice actually involved. Hobson's choice, in fact. So yes, we have six on course at the moment, and it will be seven later on. And we already have a split very, very early on with 57 laps to go. And the Derny boys starting to set their own stall out. And in fact, there's a great deal of competition between the motorcycle Derny drivers, even amongst themselves. We spoke to the riders yesterday and they said, well, mainly you just say ho if you want them to slow down, and the motorcyclists keep an eye on you and just make sure that you can keep in touch. Allez is what you say if you want them to go faster, ho if you want them to slow down. And right now it looks like a prime draw has been taken by Guy East, who's bedded in behind Ron Zeilaft, who is riding Derny number one. Coming around the outside is Michael Vazden. There he is, and his charge today is just seeing which one of the boys it is. I think it's Didier Kaspers. It is indeed. There we are. So Kaspers at the moment just about to take the lead, and good work by Michael Vaft. This is a classic event with some classic motorcycles on display, and it's provided some great entertainment, hasn't it?
It certainly has, and Michel Barton, a very experienced Derny driver, and in fact this is his 106th day where he's been pacing. Michel had a great career as a rider. Second in the Olympic Games in the kilometre in 1976, went on to become a top 6 day rider, winning the 6 day of Antwerp, rode 72 6 days. I raced with him in the 6 day of Gent, we got second, and so he wants to make a mark on his Jubilee 100th
Derny race 6 days.
Oh dear. I might ask to borrow one of these journeys and we can get out on track tomorrow. Would you trust me? I'll certainly punch a big hole in the air.
Yeah, but let's give it a go. I'm sure we'd get quite a crowd if we entertain and tell people.
I think so. Three wide. That's how they'll probably finish here. There we go. Back at Team Dalen. The masseuse doing a proper job. Looks like he's being waxed. Round the outside comes Kees Stam, journey rider number 5. And as he sails by our position here is Yuri Hoffman with 45 laps to go, 44 declared. I think he's running just slightly behind where we are on course. Nonetheless, good general view. Nice to see these guys as well, full of beans down there. And you know, Yuri Hardwick is he's almost like the spokesman for the riders. He's the first to chime up whenever they had a riders meeting. But it's Nicky Stoppler, his teammate, who is the enforcer, let's put it that way, amongst that pairing of the AA Drink Boys. Anyway, more on that in a moment. They'll be out on course a little later. Matek is suffering at the moment, I'm afraid, the number 19. And Mel Boskamp is at the back, and he's obviously been calling rather a lot to Peter Twilline and ground to make up. We've got 40 laps to do it, but already we've got a pairing that have made a break here.
Made a break. You've got team number 13 there on the attack, Didier Caspers. Looks like Peter Bowlen with his rider team number 9 there. Looks like they're just taking their time to ride in. I don't think he's in any major problem. Very experienced pacemaker there, and I think he's going to look after his rider. And I think we've seen him come to the fore in the closing stages of this race, Carlton.
I think we have seen some of the Dutch football team of old enjoying life, having dinner with a few quaffs of wine on the centre of the track as proceedings go on. And that's what six-day racing is partially about, family affair as well. And it's fantastic racing, as I am sure you are well aware. It's great to have your company live here from the Amsterdam Velodrome. It's the third day of the six that make up this phenomenal 6 days. The first of the winter season calendar. Ghent will be next, and then Rotterdam, where we'll also be live streaming for you, don't forget. Playing catch-up at the moment is Kenny De is Aaron Gate, the New Zealander. Aaron is of Anpost, Sean Kelly's favoured team. Although not in commentary, I'll say, and we are together. He's nice and neutral when he has to. Tracks out front right now, and in fact, teams 12 and 13, they've unveiled themselves this evening and taken an extra step forward, it seems.
It seems, you know, they've sat at the front in this Derny race, they've set the tempo, and fast pace, but of course, still a long way to go, 32 laps. And the great thing about the Derny is I love the noise, I love the smell, and it really gives a great atmosphere. I know it's very popular here in Holland, and we're going to see some great Derny racing before the end of this 6 day, as we have on the first 2 nights.
Yeah, it's been fantastic. 31 to go. To many people's minds, you think that the riders aren't having too much of an input here. They certainly are. And Guy East has called LA, and magical response from Ron Zeilert on the number one Derny, and he's closed the gap, and in so doing it's been a good response as well, because coming back into this one the Zeiss team, and it is Wes Crader doing a superb job as well. The pace from everybody has increased, the others have called for more speed, and it's being delivered by the men on the motor Dernys. You know, they're doing a fantastic job here at the track. Didier Caspers is looking very comfortable out front. He doesn't mind being there at all.
He doesn't, but Ron Zeilert there on the Golden Derny, he's not going to give anyone any distance. And the special bikes, only 75cc, very small. To increase the speed, you have to gradually increase the pedaling as well. There's no big throttle to open up like on a big BMW or big Harley Davidson like the U-Ride Carlton. This takes a lot of skill for the pacemakers, and they've got to really follow, concentrate on the racing, and Szilard is never going to be far away from that action.
Yeah, I think my Harley police bike would do a great job here. An old FXR rubber mounted, in case you're wondering. I need it.
Great work here.
23 laps remaining. Cross the line. And I'm enjoying this. Didier Kaspers looks very, very comfortable. I've got to say as well that Yuri Hoffman is doing a super job out there as well. And those two have been up there for much of the time. Now, you don't have the same deficit by riding on the front as you do if you were taking the win directly. And so there is not really a problem about spending much of the race out there. You're not going to save anything by being behind. It's about timing.
It's about timing. And we said earlier about Peter Bowden sitting at the back. But look at him. He's come from the back. He's now going round the outside. He's moving up into second place. And I think he's going to take the lead before another lap is completed.
This is a superb piece of work. Mel Boskamp is the rider. Has a check over his shoulder. Superb. This is lovely to see. Peter Boelen on the attack and doing so on behalf of Mel Boskamp, who is calling the shots just behind him. Sailing round the outside, he's staying up there wide. It seems you get a lot of pace with a motor journey, even if you're high up. And you'll see this traditionally finish with three abreast for the final lap, and that'll be coming in 17 laps time. This is, oh, he nearly lost his man, you know, he nearly lost him. Pedalling on is Mel Boskamp, but he looked a bit uncertain there, and he may well call Ho just to slow him down once he's taken the lead. He'll get back down low where he wants to be, but he had to work hard there to stay together with his journeyman.
Yeah, I mean, for a moment there, he was losing the back of the mudguard there, but he seems more comfortable now that he's got in front and he's able to ride a little bit lower down the track. The journey drivers really are lifting that tempo, increasing. Peter Bowden starting to just settle down. Looks like we've got Aaron Gates who's coming. One of the riders there at the back has lost his pacemaker.
Yeah, it's Wes Crader, I'm afraid, from the Zeiss team. Team number 10 lost his paceman, and he's come alongside to have a chat, and he's not happy at all. He's calling strategy. And Sam Moy looks nonplussed. So what's he delivered? What sort of message has Wes Crader said to him? Clearly it's watch where I am and maybe listen. Has a look rather sheepishly, Sam Moy, over his shoulder. You don't like to get a public lecture, but that's exactly what he had a few moments ago. Right now, Mel Boskamp is the boss. They've all had their issues out there, don't forget.
Look at him go there.
Well, where did he find that? That was absolutely beautiful. And Didier Kaspers finds the lead. Oh, but it almost immediately loses out.
Oh, mechanical for the journey.
Oh, that's a nightmare.
Oh.
He may well get another ride. We might have eight on board. We might have eight on board later on. Well, you said they were old machines. There we are. I think he's popped a gasket. I do.
I think he has, and it's not just a gasket on the journey. I reckon Michel's going to be fuming there. His 106th day as a journey driver, and his old machines let him down.
Well, there you are, the centenary, and it's gone the way, unfortunately, of the Queen Mum. What a shame. So, there we are. And so, we are left with five of the six. I think we might have eight out for the next one, if they can fix the bike. I think he will fix the bike tonight. He'll have to take another journey.
Oh, look at Aaron Gate there, the New Zealander, the World Omnium Champion, now in second place. He's going to be challenging to take the lead with four laps to go.
Aaron Gate versus Mel Boskamp. It is teams 2 and 9 out front, 3 to go. You just wait as well. Ron Szilard is going to join the party here, and he's going to drag Guy East. If Guy East can stay on board and stay in touch, you're going to have 3 wide in just a few moments' time. 2 laps to go. Now then, he can't resist Ron Szilard on the journey. Number 1, he's in 3rd place at the moment. He's had a couple of victories, and maybe he wants another one. Here we go. 2 wide it's going to be. The bell next time by. I think it's going to be between these two teams. Little bit of cheekiness just drifting up high up the track. Peter Boelen on board the journey, doing a decent job on behalf here of Boskamp.
And I think Boskamp's going to take this one. Round the outside he comes. Absolutely superb. Thank you very much, he says. No three wide this time. What about that? Look at those speeds.
Those speeds, those last five laps. Very, very quick there. And Boskamp, who you said earlier, Carton, was in trouble at the start of the race. He rode himself in there. Paced by the German Meister, Peter Baalen. And they rode very, very well there.
Wow, fantastic journey racing. We spoke to the Dalen boys a little bit earlier on, Kenny De Kendler and Heis van Hoek, my picks for the night. And I think we're going to have another look-see at that little chat we had earlier.
Are these love letters, Kenny, that that you write to each other?
Not really. No, we've got a fan from Belgium. She's actually a big fan of our team, our professional team, and she's in a wheelchair, and she whenever she sees the time and everything goes okay with her health, she comes in and supports us, and she makes this little riders, paints them, and she's also into drawings. This is apparently a drawing of me winning the Derny Heat the first day. So yeah, it's a nice motivation.
And what's her name?
Ann.
Ann. Okay.
Yep.
And does Heis have as many fans as Kenny, or who's more popular with the girls?
I don't know. Maybe we each got a mail from her, so
yeah.
We're at the same level now, but yeah. This 6 days, it was still okay with the girls.
For both of us, track was a little bit a big, yeah, like a starter for our cycling career. We both do track already from when we were young. I'm like 7 or 8 years older than he is, but we both had in the youth. We both did a lot of track racing, and we just kept doing it. And he's decided to go more for road. I think he has more abilities than me on the road, and I just focus really on the track, and road is more as a preparation for me. Mm-hmm. So that's a bit where our roads split, but the way to our professional career went through the track for both of us, I think.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple.
Welcome back. It is flying time trial time here. And the first man of the sprinters to provide the interlude for the men that are battling out for points and the title while they rest up, and we wait for the next journey. We're on a flying lap and out and on course, and doing a great job, Bart Holmes, at the moment. That was a more than a half decent time, 11:0:38, all on his lonesome. That was a piece of quality to start us off.
A good time there by the young 19-year-old. I think we're going to see 11 seconds broken very soon, though. But start off well this evening, riding well in the Kieran. And now we come to the second rider on the track. Is this big turn or not? You tell me, Carl.
He's taking his turn. He's not had the happiest of times. However, we'll see how he goes here. To be honest, he's got a lot of power, and sometimes it's misguided. Well, around he comes. He'll pace himself up right now. next time by is his flyer.
Oh, he's going very, very fast now.
Oh, you know
what?
I think
much better.
Stall set out. Now then, this is the crucial bit. This phase, as he drops off the high banking. Oh, and he's on a charge. This is going to be quality, and I think this will be the winning run today. How's about that for a prediction? Round the final curve, he comes. Start-finish line, it is in the offing. Oh, sub 11 in the bag.
Well, we've still got four riders left to go. I think we're going to see a quicker time than that before the end of the night. Good to see that Turland's getting a little bit quicker. He's got three more nights, and I think he's going to get faster each lap record attempt.
Like that a lot. 10.984. Well, we'll see if we can get close. There's some have-a-go heroes out there. Watch out for Matthias Buckley, the boy from Haarlem. Been playing with us, really. Hugo Hack as well, the orange man. He can just punish everybody. And what about the boy in silver? Here he comes, Niels van der Hoornendaal. Home track, don't forget. If you can read a track, you have a big advantage. Flying time trial on the opening day for this man. 11.107. Yesterday, well, it was underneath the 11s. A 10.883. Keeping with the Harley Davidsons, for those who know. Full charge, 10.984.
Very high up there, though.
Oh, you know what? Maybe a bit too high. Drops into the banking. Hasn't hampered him too much, has it? Yeah, it's thrown him out on the back straight. Down on the inside he comes. Yet again out towards the red line. Whoa, you know what, though? An 8.32. They're all at it.
Oh, but I mean, he just stayed so high before he came down to hit that timing strip.
Well, he's supposed to know this track like the back of his hand. Maybe he's got a lumpy back of the hand. Needs to smooth that one out, that's for sure. Here we go, Hugo Hack then. Now, Hack Attack took the opening flying TT, don't forget, of these 3 days. Yesterday finished in third place, but still with a 10.684. What's he got for us? This is his pace-up lap right now. He sails very close to our commentary position, almost nicks the sandwiches. And away he goes down the back straight. Almost immediately climbing once more for his final curve. He gets the power down. This is a full attack mode. He's out of the saddle almost slightly, and there he is. Locked down and into a proper position right now. Keeping it low on the black line almost. Virtually underneath red. Not literally so though. What's he got? 10.799.
Quickest of the night.
Not as fast as yesterday. But the track speed can vary. We'll have a chat about that, and we'll see whether that's going to be our winning time. So far, there's two more boys to go. Jeff Hoogland in the orange. He's on course at the moment. And Matthias Buckley. Here's Jeff. I have a treat for you later on. We have our predictions. I believe we may even be on screen. I hope they've got a wide-angle lens to get us both in, Tony. Later on.
But I must say, when you were doing the interview, you did look very smart.
International man of mystery, about to be revealed. So, let it be known. Here we go then. Round the outside goes Def Hoogland. Second in the sprint in the European Championships this year. So he's a man who can turn it on, and he does so. This is a proper drive. I think he might well be my outside tip for today. Let's have a look. Round he comes. 10.799 is what he's looking at. Oh, thank you very much. 10.711, open all hours.
I mean, fantastic time there. I think he could even gone quicker. He's got to learn to hold it down, but it's great to see the time getting quicker and quicker with just one rider left to go.
Well, we're having fun here. Matt Buckley is who is out there, the Dark Knight in the Panda outfit, the boy from Haarlem, just 20 years of age. But he can sprint. Here we go. Off the bank he comes, keeping it sensible.
Wow.
Absolutely solid as a rock. In fact, it was Tony's hairline was reposition there as we got a draft as he came by. Sadly, I can't say the same myself. Here we go. Full attack now. Bang. Clock starts rolling right now. Look how low. Can you go? Holds it. Oh, wavering just a little bit. That might hamper him.
Let's see. That might cost him.
10-7-11 is what he's looking for. Oh, 6-16. Fabulous performance. Matt Buckley nails it. Spinning is a charm, he is. Fantastic.
I mean, sensational time. If only he could have kept it lower down in that back straight. But, I mean, all credit to him. Super fast time there. And he's taken the win of the time trial round this evening. That's going to set out the seedings for later on when we have the knockout basis.
Looking forward to those knockouts. They take the TTs, and it is 5 and 6 who go off in you battle for 5th, 3rd and 1st later on, depending on these times. Those will be the pairings set by this. Terrific. Thank you, incidentally, for all of your kind thoughts on the website, on the internet. Those of you who are watching the live stream, Steve McGinty's written in, says fantastic feed commentary from the legendary Tony Doyle. I get a mention as well. Dirty time. How many are we going to have on course right now? Have we got a spare Dirty?
I'm sure there's a spare Dirty. I'm sure that Michel Vartner would have spent time with the mechanics, got his Dirty up and running. We're going to have 7 Dirties in this heat. Let's hope that we have no more mechanicals.
Will it be 8? Have we got 8 Dirties? And Treasure Machines. Ron Zylod's Bike 100 has bitten the dust. Get a telegram from the Queen.
And in fact,
at 100 years of age. Well, no, 100 laps.
No, it was Michel Barton's Dirty who let him in his 106th day as a Dirty driver.
Forgive me. There we are. So, Michel, will he be out here again? We'll see. We're looking for number 3. Oh, he's out here. Now, how many have we got? 2, 4, 6, 7. They're not going to get a rerun. That's a bit unkind.
A bit unkind, but just one of those things. Can't be helped. Just got 7 Dirty drivers. We've got a spare Dirty, but we haven't got a spare driver unless you want to go and take that place, Carlton. You'll drop a lot of protection.
I feel it would be my biggest skill.
Unknown talent, maybe, Carlton.
Who knows? We have many. Tell you what, while they warm up, let's take a break.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
We're here with Matthias Buckley. That looked fast, incredible. How much experience do you have with the Flying TT?
Yeah, well, I've been doing track sprinting specifically since, I think, 3 years now. So we track sprinters, we don't have too much matches in the year, but it's like 3 years experience.
Thank you.
There we are. Take your experience where you can get it. So we have 7 Dirties. Believe me, I think if they've got a spare 8, we'll be out on track.
I think the Dirty drivers now have managed to get themselves in the right order. We've got Dirty driver Kay Stam, who's sitting at the front position. And he'll be pacing team number 6. That looks like Life Lampeter.
Some of the push-off boys there got themselves into a bit of trouble. they have to push off in a line and then match up. There was a bit of practice going on earlier this afternoon, because yesterday they had a bit of a mess up and there was all kinds of arguments going on as to who was in the right place and who got the right Dirty driver. They Didn't quite match the riders with the drivers. Anyway, that was as just about textbook perfect, that melding of the talent.
Very good. They got it right tonight. The Dhoni drivers had a stern talking to by the race director, Patrick Sercue, and he didn't stand for any nonsense. But finally, the Dhoni drivers listened, paid attention, and they've got it right today.
He's not a man you cross.
No, not to be cross, not to be cross. But no, exactly. What a tremendous athlete, what a palmarès that Patrick had.
Unbelievable. I mean, to be honest, you'd run out of paper if you started writing his history.
Well, I mean, you know, Patrick is the king of the 6 days. He ended up winning 88 6 days. I think that record would never be broken.
You couldn't win more than 88 if you actually just only did 88 in a lifetime. And it wasn't as if he won everything he went for as well. So did he do anything else?
I mean, Patrick was a superb all-rounder. I mean, Olympic kilometre champion, then went on to be world sprint champion. So versatile that he was very successful on the road. Rode the Tour de France a number of times. And in fact, he ended up winning the green jersey in the Tour de France, I think it was in 1974.
He was, to many people's minds, the greatest.
And in my mind as well, I mean, to be a world sprint champion and then go on and win the races that he did in the on the road, the year that he won the green jersey, he won the longest stage of that year's Tour de France, over 245 kilometres.
There you go. Just a true versatile talent. And so, yes, he did indeed spread that joy far and wide in a whole raft of disciplines. One of the greats. Right now, we've got a superb move going on. And this is good to see. Leif Lampetum, the German, 30 years of age. He's out front. And Leif, partner of Ray Crader, doing a super job for the Beretti team in their orange jerseys. Earlier on today, you see Coupermans, that's Tristan Margay and Mark Hester, who were targeting the lap record. Didn't quite get it. They'll be back to try that again, but right now they are out and on course with our Dhoni drivers. Ron Zeilard is on Dhoni number one, playing catch-up as we speak. Hello. Out front is Heistam, who is paired with the orange boys Boretti, Leif Lampeter. They've got a bit of pace about them. They've posted a little bit of a gap, but on their case is Vlasman, Team Vlasman, and riding out there, it's Jens Maurice, the man who's looks like he's getting that suppleness absolutely when he needs it. Super job as well, and a big push on by Dalen. Kenny de Kettler and Heis van Hoek, every single discipline they are gunning for, and they take the lead as we speak. And it is Kenny de Kettler who's out front. He is boiling. Peter Boerlein, it is, that is pacing him right now. And Peter, he's, I think, of all the Dhoni drivers, if you get his name that pops up, you've got to be pleased.
Yeah, I mean, all the Dhoni drivers, they're all very experienced, as are a lot of the riders. But the way Peter came over there and took the lead, very smooth, very controlled, and he just built up the speed gradually and gradually, so he didn't accelerate and didn't make Kenny have to make any sudden reaction. But saying that, you've got team number eight, it looks like it's Mark Hester, who's coming up, moving up from second to challenge for the lead position. Having to ride very high up the bank in here.
He is, but there's plenty of space out there, especially it seems when you're guided. It might look busy out there, but we've seen three wide on two occasions, keeping it two wide. These Dhoni drivers are extremely experienced. Sam Moy, it is, the number six Dhoni at the top, and doing a great job of guiding as we speak. Tristan Margay, the Swiss rider, national Omnium champion, don't forget, in Switzerland. So got a great deal about him, but media response from Berlaine. Peter Berlaine in on the number two Dhoni and doing a magnificent job to keep Kenny de Kettler where he wants to be. He shouted Allais and they went for it and took the lead. Jens Maurice as well, and Vlasman is getting into the zone right now, and he's going high. There's 44 laps to go, and look at the pace that they are setting lap by lap. Now, they're not at full tilt just yet. Around about 61 kilometres per hour for the lap is where you're going to be when they really are going for it. Maximum speed, kilometres per hour, 56.8. And it's the skill of the Journey drivers that are to the fore here. And now to the fore, Vlasman with Jens Maurice, who drifts into position. Great work by Walter Hybenex.
I mean, Walter's very, very experienced. Walter, the fireman of the track, and now full-time concentrating on the race. He was a former fireman, very experienced, drives a lot of the Journey criteriums on the road, raced over 35 different races in Belgium, Holland and Germany this year. Loves the six-day racing, and great to see him riding with Jens Maurice. Very experienced pairing there.
It is indeed. Jens Maurice more than happy to follow this pace, and it's strung them out. And suffering at the back right now is Barry Marcus. We'll get a tag on him in at the moment, but there we are. It's a long way. It's almost the full back straight, and you'll see the back Marcus sailing through right now. Didn't hold it long enough, but the red jersey at the back just starting to suffer ever so slightly. And this is going to have a cost here. There we are. They sail through our last pairing. AA Drink still have to make a move. They've got to pick this up. And it is Nick Stobler, the sergeant major of the entire field, who's at the moment not looking overly comfortable. Michael Vaarten is his man. Don't read too much into it. It's not that he's undistant, incapable of getting back. If he calls LA, he can close that gap. It's just whether he wants to at the moment. I think he feels still moderately comfortable. We'll see. They put a lot into the early part of the morning, early part of the evening, I should say. The AA Drink boys, haven't they?
They certainly have. I think Michel might in fact be nursing his Journey. Maybe he's a little bit worried about the mechanical he had earlier. I'm sure he's got it fixed. And as we speak, he's starting to move up and make up ground. And look at the increase in speed there. It's come from the back straight round into fourth place now.
Oh, this is terrific. Position four at the moment. He's going to be in third before you know it. High around the outside. We're looking at the front, but a little bit further back is where the action's happening. There it is. AA Drinks are the boys into second place now. Sailing past the Visa squad right now. And Lichtart finds himself locked in down on the inside. Superb drive from the back almost. And now leading.
Taking the lead. And it looks like no problems there with the mechanics of the bike. And certainly seen an increase in the tempo there, and the field really starting to get stretched out now, Card. Look at it, it was spread over half a lap.
They certainly are, and indeed there's been a lot of chops and changes, and Michael Vaarten was at the back. Alley was called by De Ketteler, and he delivered as well for AA Drink, Nick Stoppler, I should say. Well, those who are resting up for other battles, having their muscles eased. Right now, it's the metal that's being tested. And indeed, it's Michael Vaarten out front, has a check over his shoulder. And yes, Nick Stoppler still there. And guess who as well, who was one of the back markers, is coming to join the front. Ron Szilard lights it up on the Journey. Round he comes on his golden Journey. And the man is digging for that right now in the red jersey is Barry Marcus. 10th in the Arctic race, don't forget, riding for Belkin. And a superb job, the Dutchman, just 22 years of age. And he's come here and he's adapted extremely well. So has Pim Lichtart. He's called for more power and he's got it. Herman Becker. He's been quiet as our Herman. And there he is, battering his way through. Herman the Sherman will be calling him before you know it. Like a tank, he sends his way round the outside. There's a number of lines you can take late on. 24 laps to go. Last lap, a 59.10. That's the fastest we've had so far.
I think they're settling down into a rhythm now as we come round with 23 laps to go. Michel Barth not wanting to give up that front space there with team number five, the rider from the AA team, and that's Stoppler. Looks like they're settling out in front, but I think we're going to see a lot of action in these last 20 laps.
There we are. When we're saying a 59.49, we're talking kilometres per hour, incidentally. I'm just looking, actually, fastest was just over 60, and we're back up there, 61. They can't help themselves. These are speed guns throughout, don't forget. And right now the pace is cranking up with 20 laps to go. They've called for it and it's been delivered. And it's Nick Stoppler who's most vocal.
He certainly is. He's very loud. I can even hear him over the noise of the Dernies.
It'll be hand signals for you later on, I can tell you. Especially if he doesn't like what we're saying. Barry Marcus in second place with Ron Tyler driving him along on his Dernie. We have four locked out and they look like they're the ones that are going to contend this. Can they possibly go four wide for the line? I don't think there's enough space. Lotsman look like they've got ground to make up. Jens Maurice, is he going to call it? Is he going to call for more pace? You know who's suffering right now is Kenny De Ketelaar.
Yeah, Kenny De Ketelaar looks like he's sitting in the back. I think he's calculated. I think he knows exactly what he wants to do. I think he's going to have a late run in this race with 16 laps to go. Just watch Kenny, that team number four at the back, being paced by Peter de Bouwland. I think we're going to see them and make a real run for it. And as we speak, there you see they start to move up, coming from the back. Still got to make up half a lap though.
There we are, number four immediately calls for it and he goes for it. He was plumb at the back, he's made up two spots right now. Allez, allez, he says, as we still stay with the man who's in the lead at the moment, Pim Ligtart. But it's about the move that's being made by number four. This is a crucial point of the night. He's got half a lap to make up and look at the speeds, 65.18. Number four out there and sailing round, doing a great job, is Kenny De Ketelaar, and he's reaching boiling point right now. Those are the guys out in the back. The intermediate rider is the one we want.
Look at it, they're really drawn out now.
There he is, hoving in, and he's kind of come back and get on the tail end, and that's exactly what he's done. Still trying to make up ground. Number four, Kenny De Ketelaar, out in front of him. There is a quartet. Has he been lost? That's at the back.
Peter Bowen on his pacemaker, just gradually and gradually, he's winding them in and he's eating into that lead. So he's doing well in excess of 65 kilometres an hour to make up this gap, and just watch him go. As we say that, Kenny De Ketelaar is coming up to catch the four riders in front. I don't think he's going to wait there. I think he's going to go on the attack straight away. He's going to aim to overtake a lot of them in one lap.
Here comes Kenny De Ketelaar lining it up. We've been calling him for some time. He's been out the back, in the middle, and now he wants a piece of this. Come on, Kenny. He's going for this one absolutely brilliantly. Six laps to go. He's hide round the outside. Here he comes. He's on the attack, is he? Absolutely. Round the bend they go, sending me likewise. Oh, this is absolutely superb. We have them absolutely locked together. There's no room for him to come out. Is it a lockout?
It's a lockout. There's no room. They're three abreast. He's going to have to wait and see if he can find a gap. It looks like there might be a little gap opening up there. Team number seven there, if the turning driver there can hit the front.
Well, it looks like it is going to be a lockout. The gate has been slammed shut. He's been making superb progress. Now this is going to take a supreme piece of work by Peter Boerlein, and he's got it. He's got the line. Here he comes into third place. Third place now for Kenny De Ketelaar. Come on, Kenny. This is a superb ride. The crowd go absolutely crazy, and he's high round. Wide the wide boards. It's the bell this time by Kenny De Ketelaar. It's got to go all the way. Long, long, long run. He's got one more lap. Dips down on the inside. Absolutely superb. Oh, he's going to make this. High, and there's the line. That was a piece of genius.
Fantastic. I mean, I could hear Kenny screaming, alley, alley. Peter Bowling timed it to perfection. A late, late run. But what a ride by the German and the Belgian combination there. Fantastic. So Kenny, a deserving winner there, picks up 5 points and wins the second heat of the Dernie. Fantastic
that
stuff.
Was a piece of genius. He was clawing his way back through the field. I'm sorry we didn't trace those pictures for you, but he was amazing. He was at the back, he was in no man's land, and then the door appeared to be slammed shut in front of him. We had three wide on the track. There was no way through, and then he kicked the door in and invited himself to the party and ate the cake.
Well, quite right, of course. These 6 day tracks, that much smaller, that much narrower, and there's just not the same room there is on some of the bigger tracks. But Kenny didn't panic, Peter Bowerland didn't panic. They waited, they knew that a gap was going to open up, and then they really excelled. They drove and they got it to perfection. I mean, and all credit to them. That was a real example of pacemaking and rider coming together. And look how cool he looked there.
Job well done, fellas. Peter Boulain gets a slap on the back, and Kenny de Ketelaar. He was boiling out there.
I mean, what a race. That was par excellence Sterni racing.
You know what? This is great, isn't it? Laura Weislow says, got to say, I've never heard anyone get that excited about a Sterni race. Laura, you've got to be here. You've got to be here. Alan, you're as near as damn it. On the web, hope you're enjoying the live feed that we've got here from the Amsterdam Arena. It is fantastic. Look at that for a big grin. Verlaine, oh, he's been waiting for that all night. Not the flowers.
And look at all the press, all the cameramen there, all the photographers on the line. They really liked that, didn't they?
Oh, me too. Wow, I hope you're being royally entertained. We're feeling cock-a-hoop here, and that was a great piece of work. Ken's done it. Belgians are happy. Absolutely super.
Yeah, I mean, just look at it. And they really, really enjoyed that, didn't they? Look at the speed there. That was brilliant, wasn't it?
In every respect, both tactics-wise, the strength, the determination, and the interchange between those two guys. Oh, great.
Clear winners there.
We're going to get downstairs. Greg is just waiting for them to take the applause. I think they've got about three quarters of a lap. These guys do like to get the plaudits, and why not? That was a fantastic piece of racing. We got the Sprint Boys on track for you in just a few moments' time. And it will be Gregor asking the questions in just a few moments when I'm hoping Kenny it is that comes through to answer a few. Then we will have, what's up next?
We've got the Sprint Masters semi-finals, and then after the Sprint Finals, we've then got the Super Sprints. So still a lot of racing, a lot of action to go.
It's Gregor with our winner.
Here we are with Kenny de Ketelaar. Kenny, talk us through your tactics for winning the Sterni.
Well, at the end there wasn't a lot of tactics. We started good in the front. We went a little back when the others were accelerating. But I think we let them go a bit too far. And we had to do a big pursuit of 20 laps. And in the beginning I thought we were going to make it. But at the end we had like four laps to go when we make it to the top trio. And we could take away some gas, and then in the end it was full on, and I heard the motor was just almost at its maximum. I have oil spots on my legs everywhere. You can really see the effort of the journey, so my effort was a bit harder as well.
You came from behind. Did the Belgian fans make a difference?
Yeah, they do. We have a lot of fans. I have every year the same sponsor here. Became a personal friend of mine already, and yeah, it's so nice. He motivates people. He's like when he gives an applause, it's got extra decibels. So it's great, and all the audience was good. It's good to make a big show.
Thank you, Kenny.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
Welcome back. You join us for the Sprintmaster semi-final. They've had a track stand which has gone on for ages. Twin Mulder looks like he's in the driving seat, but Buckley has got something to say about that, and in fact takes it. This will be setting them their stall out, so it will be Buckley that rides off for the Sprintmaster's final, riding against the winner of the next of this semi-final runoff. Good work, very good work. Tone Mulder in second place, so he'll be riding off for third when we get to the final coming up after the super sprint for the Madison boys. Wow, just about got my breath back after that Derny race. That was absolutely amazing. Let's move on to the sprint, guys. The Madison Masters are just taking themselves a brief break down there, just working their way into the evening. It is a fabulous way of enjoying your track cycling. If you can get to a six-dayer, then please do. And there's still time, of course, although tickets, I understand, are very close to the max for the next 3 nights. So if you want tickets, then get on the website and check them out. Amsterdam, an easy place to get to from just about all over Europe. Schiphol, provided the wind's not blowing, welcoming everybody. Here we go, then. We got Jeff Hulant in the orange. We have Bart Holmes. And we have the Silver Surfer, Niels Van Hunenda. Here we go. Who's your money on? Jeff, they've got to watch that Bart Holmes doesn't mug them again. just go mad from distance, which he did earlier.
He did earlier, yeah. I think, he's certainly the man in form, and he's the one to watch out. But it's always very difficult in these three up heats to predict exactly what's going to happen. A normal traditional sprinting, it's matches of two, so three riders on the track. Of course, they're only racing over three laps, so there's not a lot of time for tactics.
Bart Holmes has decided he is going to go early, but Jeff Hulland knows the danger and matches him for pace and holds him on the outside. Now all he's got to do is hold him there, hold him, and as he takes the bell, then he's the man that's going to be taking the longer way round. Elbows to the fore, yeah, a little bit of a clash, a little bit of a nudge, and it's Niels van Hunendaal who takes advantage. He's going highest of all up above the blue line, and I think it's going to be the man in silver that takes it. Oh, I'm not sure though. It might well have been Bart Holmes, the 19-year-old. No, Niels van der Hoedendaal says that was me.
Well, I mean, he had to come from way back, ride very high up the track, but experience paid off there, and he knew exactly what he was doing, and he's going to take that win. So get through to the sprint final there. Oh, yes, comfortable in there. You can see that there in slow motion.
They were busy taking energy from each other with their shenanigans down on the inside. Bart Holmes and Jeff Hulland will not be sending each other Christmas cards, I imagine. Niels van der Hunendaal, however, cock a hoop. He'll be going through to the final to race off for maximum points amongst the Sprint Meister boys. We've got a super sprint coming up next. This is one of my favourites.
Yeah, all the riders on the track. I mean, we're going to have the presentation here for the winner of the Sprint Masters before all the teams come out onto the track, gradually get themselves together for the next event of the Madison Masters.
Yeah, the super sprint. I think we'll take some time just to explain to you. Well, I'll tell you what, let's take a break and then we'll tell you all about it when we get back. Here we go.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
It's been so busy, and we can take an awful lot of joy in that. I think they look like they're taking a lot of joy as well. They don't even know they're on camera, you know.
Join it.
They certainly are. So they are circulating our gladiators. Very much feeling like that now, isn't it not? Here we go. There's your general classification. Lampeter Crater on the lead lap, but also look at the points that they've got. De Ketteler and Hoek, look at that. They're a lap behind, but 136 points. They can't rely on just building up, reaching the next 100 benchmark and getting that back. They've got to start thinking about taking a lap on Lampeter and Crater.
Yeah, they're not going to get to 200 points anywhere near that by the end of the night. And if they want to make up that lap advantage, they're going to have to really press for the advantage in the Madison.
So what have we got? I tell you what we've got. We have the Super Sprint. It's an elimination. Every six laps, we will trim off the back one team. Just like the old elimination race that we had earlier on this evening. There's the gun. A pigeon suddenly hits the centre of the track. Then, once four teams have been eliminated, okay, that's the magic number, we then have just nine riding off for the points. Clear? Hope so.
Let's hope they are, because I think by now we're finally understanding this event. But of course, for the riders that haven't ridden the Derny, this is going to give them a chance to warm up, prepare for the final event of the evening.
Yep. So what you've got is a partial elimination. We get rid of four teams, okay? So those in three laps time, the first of those will be clipped off the back. And once we get down to nine teams, they're allowed to go until the end for the points.
Well, the nine teams are left with 12 laps, so they sprint it out over those 12 laps. So two laps before the first team is eliminated.
There we go. So those at the front right now might be feeling reasonably confident. However, never count your chickens. And in fact, further down the order, we have Leif Lampeter and Ray Crader in the orange. They've got to take some care because they're in a danger zone at the moment, especially as Marcel Katz is just behind at the moment for the Visa boys in white. There's the bell. Now, watch the back end, because that's where it will trim out. And they're quite widely spread here, so one team of quality looks like they're going to disappear. And it's now, and it's going to be the men in white, and it looks deliberate. Why is that?
Well, I mean, one thing there, they got the change all wrong. There's no good changing in the banking, coming around to the line. So that didn't help, but probably a tactical move. There's a lot at stake for this final event, the Madison. But there's points on offers all the time.
Well, as I say, they're racing on, so it's not them. I believe it's the Beretti boys. Let's have a look. No? Yes. No? Yes. Indeed, our first team to be eliminated, and you'll have to forgive us because it's busy out there. Team 6, Lampeter and Crader actually took the handshakes and said adieu. So Lichtart and Kaltz were not knocked off the back that time, although they're hanging around.
And you've got Arrogate and Luke Roberts, the team in yellow, they're set the tempo. And they're using this as an opportunity to prepare, get themselves ready for the Madison. Need a good workout. Man of great experience, Luke Roberts, there. And to just sit on the front.
You know, I'm going to put it on the line here. I think if Pim Lichtart gets trimmed off the back here, Marcel Katz is in white, the Visa boys, you just wait and see when it gets to the big Madison. I think you're going to see a big early burst for a lap from the first team, number one, Lichtart, helped out and driven on and shared by the sixth team of Lampeter and Crader. So the bell's gone.
and his teammate who have gone out this time.
Ah, well, you see, master plan has been nullified. But, you know, some big names here are just taking it easy on this one, and I think saving themselves for the big 45 minutes at the end of the night.
And understandably so. I mean, there's so much at stake, and the guys realise that the Madison, the final event of the evening, that's going to be crucial. And laps will definitely be won and lost. It won't all be down just to points tonight.
Absolutely. Hello to everybody at home. This is where we are. It's Amsterdam. It's magnificent. And I wouldn't be surprised if we get a bit of a surprise win here. Something a bit out of the box, a bit from left field. Watch Team 12, Yuri Hochman and Wojtek Hecki. You never know, eh?
No, I mean, still 11 teams left in it. There's two more teams to be eliminated before we get down to the final nine who are going to contest the sprint over those 12 laps.
Absolutely magnificent. De Telegraaf as well, Aaron Gate and Luke Roberts. They're not having a bad time of things, but it could be an awful lot better. They started today five laps in arrears, and that's the sort of total that starts to get very, very serious. They're all getting serious out here. The bell went last time by, and a sort of a half-hearted lunge for the line there by Marcel Katz. He didn't look like he was on full gas there at all, but at least he gave a lungette.
He gave a lungette, and yes, it's team number one who are out of the race at the moment.
I think we've invented a word there.
Still got the boys in yellow, team number two, who have been setting the tempo, sat at the front of the string of the riders virtually the whole of the race.
So we have nine remaining. If I admit my, are we got nine or ten? Is it one more still to be trimmed off?
One more team to be eliminated.
There we are, and then we will run for the line. So ten still out there on course. They look like they are serious about this, about staying in touch. We'll see whether Kenny De Kettler is at the back here. He's been extremely busy. He's getting, handing over right now to Gijs van Hoek. The Belgians, you know, they're having some fun with us out here. Don't forget, if he doesn't get trimmed off this time, he's got to race the rest of this. Does he want to? That's the question. Final lap. Is there a sort of a negative race going on at the back here so that you don't have to contest the final run for home?
I think so, but I think you might well see Robert Bartko going out this time. The rider number seven.
You know what? It wasn't.
It wasn't, though. So team number four, the Belgian boys.
Taking some rest. They know what they're doing. So, we have
12
this
laps.
Situation, and it's 12 laps. 10 called on the board, but usually a diamond doesn't. But anyway, we'll get the bell with one to go. And right now, this is a big opportunity for the likes of East and Holloway. Likewise for Hoffman and Crader, Hoffman the South African with Wes Crader in the silver jerseys. The Americans, they've gone stars and stripy, sort of Captain America styling with Dan Holloway and Guy. He might well score decent points here, and that's clearly what they're hoping for. They're sailing it round, and this is proper now. And it is Jesper Alseman and Mel Boskamp, the 19, who are pacing everybody just for now. Coming and joining the fun, Vlasman with Jens Maurice and Wim Stöttinger, and it is in fact Stöttinger who is running in P2 at the moment. Well, just tracing them round as we do. AA Drink still very much involved here, and happy to pick up points and happy to ride this one through. Looking at 13 team of tracks, that's Didier Kaspers and Van Zyl. Do you think we might get a surprise here with Hochman and Hecki?
I think team number two, the boys in yellow from Telegraaf, I think they're going to make their mark. I think they've decided, they set all that pace making early on in the race, and I think they want these 20 points that are on offer.
So do Hochman and Hecki in the green for We Publish, and just balked a little bit by a change, and Didier Kaspers picks it up big time, and he's going for this one. He's on the attack. Look at this. Not hanging back. In fact, it's Mel Van Zyl, I beg your pardon, He really is going. This is the change over now with Didier Kaspers. Three laps to go. Have they mucked the field here? They want it. Go, he says, after Berner's time. And away they go. This is fantastic. Two laps to go. Be the bell in a wee while. But look at this Vlasman. Start to pick it up. Jens Maurice and Studdinger working extremely well together. Nice change as well, as Nolan Hoffman takes over from Wes Crater for the boys in silver. The Zeiss team, there's a lot at stake for some of those guys who've not had too much glory so far, and I think they burned their bridges early, the tracks boys, as Kasper runs out of steam. Vlasman's taking the bell. He's going to come round the outside here. This is absolutely superb. That's a win for them. Thank you so much. Team 3 deliver, and in the hands of Wim Stoetinger, taking the line.
They took the win there. They got their change right for the last change. Luke Roberts there came in late for that change, team number 2. But a deserved win by Wim Stoetinger and Jens Maurice. 20 valuable points there.
Fabulous. Well, great racing. It's not over yet. We have the race-offs, don't forget, for the Sprint Masters. So it will be of the semi-final where we have the trios on track. But just confirmation of those points. Maurice and Stoetinger get the max. That's good for them. Gate and Roberts, good boys. Picking up 12. Stoffel at Narvik. Hockman and Hecky getting 8 points. That will be a big bonus to them. Good to see. Wes Crader and Nolan Hoffman finishing reasonably high up that last discipline. Next up, it's our 3 heats. For the flying laps, we had the seedings. Then this is the decider. So they'll be racing off 5 versus 6, 3 versus. They're racing for 5th, 3rd, and 1st.
That's right.
I got there in the end.
We've got 3 heats. We've got the presentation here for the winners of the super sprint, and just waiting to be presented with their flowers. And they certainly made their presence felt in that event, didn't they?
They certainly did. You can see how steep it is out there. Why do the Dutch have 3 kisses?
Third time lucky. And I should know.
Good work. Jens Maurice looks delighted. That was a good push. They had their chance and they took it.
Yes, they certainly did, and they got their change over just right.
I think the fact that some of the leading lights so far decided to take their exit, they knew that in the absence of that, they couldn't get any respite themselves. They had to take the maximum points here. It was almost like the duty passed to them as the other guys stepped back.
Well, I mean, when the lead teams, when they're eliminated, it's a chance for the other teams to make the most of that opportunity. And team number 3 really grabbed that opportunity. It looks like Jens Maurice is really enjoying this lap of honour. A track man for a long, long time. Had a very hard, tough, long road season riding for the Australian team Orica GreenEdge. But you can see that he's now finding his track legs and he's getting better day by day.
Yeah, I think he's actually enjoying himself. 6-day racing, it can be something of a mystery to some.
Well, 6-day racing got a tremendous history. First 6-day was held in London in 1875. The first 6 days were one rider on the track racing for those 6 days themselves.
Here we go, downstairs, let's have a chat.
Maurice and Wim Stoetinger. There was an aggressive final. Can you walk us through how you did that?
Yeah, I needed to wait a bit longer to get in the track because I'm the fastest and Jens is the diesel of us. So he stayed a bit longer in the track, and then in the end came in the right position, and then we knew it was good.
Perfect. Thank you, guys.
This program is presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
Welcome back. We are busy with the Sprintmeisters, Tony.
Sprintmeisters, yeah, the ride off the 5th and 6th. Hugo Haak and Geoffrey Hoogeland, both men in tremendous form, both medalists in the European Sprint Championship at the weekend.
Yeah, and a surprise that they're racing off for such a lowly spot tonight. But this is bragging rights, this is all about. Oh, that was tight, very tight. Did Hoogeland get that? I think he might have done.
I think as well, he just got that.
Well, don't forget we have the race off for 5th. Next up, race off for 3rd. Geoff Hoogeland takes that. They, you know, they kind of take anything they can get. Every single race is about just winning that. Doesn't matter what it's for. Even if it's for position, it means a lot to these guys.
Yeah, it means a lot to these guys. The chance for them to race in front of a home crowd with their sponsors, family and friends. I mean, what a close finish there. I think they're right on the inside, just got it.
I think you're absolutely right. Bit of pat on the shoulder as they... these guys get to know each other very, very closely over 6 days. The sprint interludes. Next up, we have Turn Mulder and Bart Holmes. Now, Bart Holmes, has, there he is, 19 years of age. How's about that for confidence?
Very,
he's got the look.
He's got the look, very confident. It's the apprentice and the master here from the Dutch sprinters. Turn, very experienced. Two times world champion, Olympic bronze medalist. Really knows his way around this track. Spent a lot of time training here. But he's not going to want to give this one away, is he?
He is not, but Bart Holmes, you know. He has made some great marks so far today. He took the opening sprint event, incidentally, because they just didn't give him enough respect. And away he went, just left them all behind in the Keirin. Will he do it this time? I think Turn Mulder knows how to handle him right now.
I think he does, but you know, it's youth against experience here. Now let's see what they're going to do. Are we going to see a track stand? Not this time.
Well, we saw a treble track stand earlier on, incidentally, as part of this competition. Turn Mulder, not going to be afraid to take it on. Got the inside line on the track, and now he's going to take him right out to the barriers. Oh, now, will there be a bit of shenanigans?
Oh, he's pinning him to the fence. Look at that.
Oh, and here's the response. There he goes. Driving it. Bart Holmes, he's not going to be allowed to come down. Will he be? Oh, a little shimmy. Now watch Bart Holmes. He's got the drive from behind, but Turn Mulder, I think, has got the pace to carry this to the line. Well, it was close, but Turn Mulder was the daddy.
Yeah, I mean, he used those tactics there to wrap him up. I think he scared Bart there by keeping him so high up on the track.
So it is the final right now. Here we come, coming up to their marks. The boys that did it earlier. Now Nies van Hernendaal, here he is, getting ready to do his duty. This is going to be fascinating, actually. up against him, Matthias Bushley, boy from Haarlem, 20 years of age. Niels, also 20, actually, and this is his home track. The man in silver should know this like the back of his hand. Every track is different. It does play a part, doesn't it, local knowledge?
It certainly does, and they both spend a lot of time riding on this track. There's other tracks in Holland that they use. Obviously, they spend a lot of time on the track in Apeldoorn. We've just had the European Championships. But this track, it gets a great deal of use all year round. And not only by the elite riders, it's given a chance for the amateur locals to have a go. There's lots of different training sessions right throughout the winter. There's always people riding on this track, no matter what time of year.
Niels picks it up, gets a bit of pace in there, almost. Brookley gets on the inside of him, doesn't want him to be there. And the bell already ringing before they even hit the line. This is it, final lap time right now. Niels van der Hoonendaal has got some pace, but so has Brookley. And here he comes, can he get back of him? A little bit of drafting. He's got to go the long way round. Can the man in black deliver here? He's going for it. Oh, it's tight. And I think he got there.
I think we're going to have to wait for the photo. I'm not quite sure there. Oh, he thinks he's got it, the man in black. Let's wait for that photo. Let's wait for the commissaire's decision.
Well, that was a superb drive for the line. And I think he did get there in the end. Matt Buchli, has he been declared? He has.
I'm not sure if he's been awarded the win yet when they're looking at a photo. And here we see it.
Oh. Well, we need it a bit slower than that.
Buchli just got it. I came from the outside.
There we are.
Great sprint match there.
He went the wrong way round. The long way round. Then it's be the long way was the right way. Say that in China. Matthias Buchli then taking that one. He's getting some bragging rights, isn't he?
Yes, certainly is. He's taking a lot of scalps, but he really is a man in form and riding very well here in the 6 days of Amsterdam. Waiting for Matthias Buchli.
Here we are, Tony Doyle and Carlton Kirby. Can you let us know what will happen in Final Madison this evening?
Well, it's going to be amazing. It has been throughout. There's no doubt about it. De Kettler and, for me, Van Hoog are absolutely outstanding. These guys, they're constantly in the frame. They've never dropped down. They're the guys who kind of like to manage things. And, well, personally speaking, I think that they are my favourites to actually take the entire title, never mind this evening. But it's a crucial point. We're at the halfway mark. By the time we get there, it's exactly halfway through the 6 days. Those guys mean business.
Tony, your predictions?
I think we're going to see a fantastic Madison. We've had two great Madisons the first two nights, and it's been decisive into the overall standings. But I think tonight we might see Robert Bartko, the older German pro, most experienced rider, ridden over 76 days. He's been very, very quiet the first couple of nights. And I think he's slowly been finding his legs. So I think he could well be in contention. I think he could be a bit of a dark horse tonight. And I think possibly team number five, the boys from the AA team, I think they've showed themselves. And they're not going to be prepared to sit back and let the Belgians dictate the racing.
As if by magic, the umpire band strike up. They actually did used to have a live band in the middle. Almost a shame that the men with the brass interview, the brass instruments, are no longer still with us. We have a chat, I think, with our sprintmeister in just a few moments' time, and then you know what's coming. It's the big one. 45 minutes of Madison. I can't wait.
First two nights we saw two tremendous Madisons, and I think tonight the touch paper is going to be lit. I think we're going to see the field spread all over the place. I think some of the lesser teams are going to be really panicking at the number of laps which they could be losing. I think the first four teams here will really be challenging to try and take that lead position. I think at the end of the night we're going to see someone different in the lead.
Well, there we are. There's a bit of a prediction. I think that some teams have actually kept something back for this. Expect early attacks. And you just wait and see. Team 6 and Team 1. I think you've got something going at the moment. I think they're sort of going to be helping each other out, let's say. Gun goes then. 45 minutes of racing plus 6 laps. Watch for the early attacks. The Telegraph boys are taking it on. These are not that far from the back. They're sort of mid-range at the moment. I'm expecting to see some fireworks from them. Team 8, Tristan Marquet and Mark Hester, they've been keeping things a little bit quiet. 8-1, my tip for certainly a pairing on an attack. So teams forming an alliance out there. And here we are, tight on the inside of the track right now. A little train starting to form. And if you come out of that train, it shows a bit of intention. And right now, the Blasman boys are just tracking Nick Dart and Katz in the white, the Visa men. And I'm not surprised, because they essentially backed out earlier on of the super sprint to keep some legs for this. And I'm not surprised, 45 minutes is a long old time at a decent pace. And they're going quickly here.
Well, they are going quick. I mean, in the 45 minutes and 6 laps, I mean, they're covering around 50 kilometers, around 40 kilometers, so they're not hanging around, not at all.
They certainly are not. So who's going to be the first to reach out and grasp the nettle? The pace started to rise ever so slightly. I think you're absolutely on to something there, Tony. I think that there is going to be some big gaps at the end of the day. We're reaching the peak point of our 6 days in terms of the midway point, I should say. And from then on, the tired legs really are going to be on display. The Telegraph at the back, they've given a lot of energy to the super sprint. Likewise, the Silvermen, Crader and Hoffman. And it is Nolan Hoffman that's leading us round just for now. A little flick out of the elbow to say, come on, help out. And going into that duty and doing so is Wojciech Hecki for the men in green we publish.
You wait for it. I think we're going to see team number 5. They're going to be the first team to launch the attack, and I think they're going to be the first team to take a lap tonight. I just see by the look in their eyes.
I think it's team 1. There you go. So we've got a little side bet going on right now. Will it be 1? Will it be 5? Will it be them together? Well, that would be a nice piece of serendipity. Yes, team 5, AA Drink, Stoppler and Harvick, the bosses, they think. Well, cranking it up out front. We're all wrong. It's team number 9, Boskamp and Asselman, that decide to go. And there they go, and chasing on. Great work, Dan Holloway and Guy East are on the chase. And it's Dan Holloway who's been wise to this. He's the strategist within the team. He's the man that can kind of deliver this sort of thing. Now, if he doesn't pose that much of a danger, and look at the response time and pace from those behind. And it's Trax that pick it up. And it's Van Zyl who decides to go off because he knows this is a chance here that these guys might get a lap back. Likewise, East and Holloway know this is a golden opportunity. They're 9 down overall, so they've got some respite, maybe a little bit of a go-kart from everybody around them. Team 9 started the evening 6 laps down, don't forget. So this is no great danger to the pack. Team 13, Kapsas and Van Zyl, 8 laps down. So this trio, they can kind of let them go, and they know that, and that's what we're seeing now.
Yeah, we're seeing these three need to get together to share the pacemaking. The major contenders are not too concerned, so they're going to let this one go. And great bit of riding there by the Americans to pick the right wheel to go on.
Hey, but look at this, pace goes up, and it's Dalen that start leading it. And in fact, as they hit the curves here, they really are putting in plenty of effort. And it's guess who? Kenny De Kettler. Absolutely. There he is, rocking and rolling, traced by Tristan Marquet from the Koopmans, team number 8. Oh, this is fantastic. Dropping down, almost getting the wrong man. Yeah, those two pink jerseys, pretty similar out there, but the boys at least are not making the mistake. Lovely handover, and Nolan Hoffman picks it back up again for the man in silver. And that trio, I think they may well just make it. although the train as it's starting right now, I think this might be a battle of attrition amongst some of the big names. And you know, team number one, they're not in a great place at the moment. I think fatigue is even showing amongst some of the principal riders here.
I think you're right. I think some of the big teams here, team number four, they don't want three other smaller teams to go away and have the glory of taking that first lap. I think they want it all back together before we see a major attack from one of the major lead teams.
Well, this is a heartbreaker, and I tell you, the man who is leading this at the moment is he goes down as a bit of a bully, and why not? Kenny DeKettler, he's been fantastic in this, and he did most of the driving to nullify this break for a lap. Those boys won't be overly delighted about it. I think that was their best chance of making it. And suddenly we get pick up a pace. Barry Marcus, Rob Bartko for the Braden Nord Red team number seven. Here they are. And in fact, failure written all over the faces of those who went for it out front. And as if by magic, it is team one that are having a crack here, along with Marcus and Bartko, team number seven. So we weren't that bad, were we?
Not that bad at all. And they've gone as soon as they caught those three. They're back together. Looks like we've got team number nine trying to jump on this bus as well. Are they going to make it? Are those three going to start working together? Well, team number seven, one and nine.
This is a big reach. Now, they knew as well, Lichtart and Kautz for the Visa team in white, they knew that those around them in the general classification for the 6 days, the Dalen boys, had burned themselves a little bit. So as soon as the catch was made of the escapees, they have themselves lit it up. And this is a very, very strong move right now. A crucial one as well.
Yeah, a crucial one. And it's always important to get that first lap under your belt. And team number one here, if they get that before any of the major teams, that will send a very powerful message out to the others. The other leading teams are then on catch-up, Calvin.
They certainly are. They're on catch-up because they will get a lap back. They'll begin to put themselves into a leading position. Now, don't forget, Lamperton and Crater are on 89 points as they came into this evening. As far as the tallies are concerned that they've made up tonight, we'll have that for you later. But one thing is for sure, and that is that the number one team of Lichtart and Kautz want to make the break. If they can get onto the tail end, and they're not that far away right now, as you can check it, if you look across, we have half a lap separating them. So they're out of sight of each other right now. And this is a good move, very good move, solid.
Good move indeed. I mean, in fact, it's over half a lap now. So I think we can safely say that these three teams, 1, 7 and 9, they're going to get this lap. There's a bit of a lull in the string of riders at the front now. They're going to wait till it comes back together and then just see who's going to be the first team to attack. They've got to get that lap first, though.
They have, and they are around about one of the straight lengths away from getting back on the end. You will hear the super tanker sound. It's foghorn. That's how they're marking the fact that breakers have made it back onto the edge of the train and got a lap on the field. Significantly here, it is that Lichtart and Kautz, team number one, who I predicted would go for this, have done exactly that, and they will be back on zero, so they'll be up there very much in very good company.
Yeah, very much so. And that's it. There you go, you hear that, it's fantastic sound. So as a rider, it's great when you hear that horn blowing.
You know you've done the job. Brief hiatus now, wait for the attack. Here it comes off the banking, maybe next time by somebody's going to pick this one up. Beastman are there, but you know, so are Dalen yet again. They did a lot of driving, and I think that was a mistake early on. I think they should have let some of those other guys go for it early on. Some of those who didn't really matter further down the order, just for the time being.
Team number four on the attack, as you say that. They didn't like the way you were talking.
They did not. They're going to show us good and proper, and here we are, De Kettler and Van Hoek. They'll be raising a glass to them in the centre.
What a decisive attack.
No hanging around. And the response has been drawn out. And it's Lampeter and Crader from Baretti in the orange. Team number six. There's no hope for them. They've got to go for this. And also, who are going to be driving this on? Of course, it's going to be team number one, Lichtart and Kautz. They're going to have to take on some driving duties here to try and nullify this. But this is a good drive. This is a good effort. And if they can get a team with them, and AA drinks are coming up right now, likewise Baretti, they're going to have some solid allies.
Baretti, team number six, team number five, got to work together. Team number four, doesn't look like they're going to wait for anybody. They're going to try and take this lap on their own.
Oh, this is fantastic. If they can get on, they'll then continue the pace, I am sure, and stop those behind them who are also trying to bridge over from making it round as well. They are in evil mood, and we love to see it. Kenny De Kettler and Heinz van Hoek together. Lovely changes they're making. And of course, they've got track space here. There's nothing to stop them taking the best line through every single corner. And they're absolutely locked on that black line, aren't they?
Yeah, they're riding very low on the track, riding very much in control. And it's going to be a tremendous boost to their morale. It's always hard to take a lap for a team on their own, but decisive, they're going to do it. And that's really going to frighten some of the other teams. There's nothing that Team 1 can do about this. Just wait. Team number 4 now coming around. They're in the same straight as the back of the string of riders.
Wow, just sailing by Nolan Huffman, who's taking a rest up here. He's got about, I'd say, 40 metres still to go. There we are, we're tracing them right now. They had a fantastic journey race as well, so they didn't hold back. They have at every single point of the evening tried to deliver, and that's a credit to them. They're not afraid of any discipline.
No, not at all. And as you say that, they've team number four have got back onto the string of riders. We're going to hear that horn going any second now. They've got their lap. We've still got team number six, team number five, who stuck out there. Haven't got that lap yet. They've had to work very, very hard for it.
Well, the Foghorn man has missed his button, but believe me, they are back on. So we didn't hear the super tanker, but we'll get it a little bit later. Check this out. Lichtenstein Cats, De Kettler, Marcus and Bocco, what teams 1, 4, 7 and 9, but De Kettler and Van Hoek are the vital ones because they have been very much part of the leadership of this 6 days, and deservedly so as well. In fact, the other pairing that were out there and driving AA Drink are just about to get on as well, along with Beretti team Lampeter and Crader. So AA Drink, Nick Stoppler and Jurik Harvik are also making it back on here. Well, it seems that the super tanker has taken its leave.
It certainly does, but that hasn't stopped team number 3 and team number 8 going off the front together. Looks like they're sharing the pacemaking very well. Got the experienced rider, the Jens Morris, and with Mark Hester, with their younger, inexperienced partners. They've got a good advantage there already, Carlton.
They certainly have. Vlasman boys, Jens Maurice and Vince Dürtinger, they've been working extremely hard. Vince Dürtinger acknowledges that he's the fast man out there, and Jens is the diesel, but they've had a victory tonight. I don't think it's going to be in this one, but they've got a good pairing alongside them here, the Koopmans boys, Tristan Marguet and Mark Hester, who've also been shining very brightly, haven't they, this evening and throughout.
Yeah, they've both teams are really starting to come to show themselves, come to the fore. Team A have been excelling in the flying two-lap time trial, but Jens Morris, big, tall, very strong, very powerful, and his pursuiting skill is coming to the fore now. And always a bit of confusion there with the changes, and it looks like happening?
Well, they didn't want to take on duties, and so Vlasman boys and indeed the Koopmans boys, teams 3 and 8, seem to have lost a bit of heart there for a moment. Well, they picked it back up, but they're arguing with each other.
I mean, as we see that mistake there, we hear the music coming in, don't leave me this way. So the music is in tune with the riders after all.
Oh my goodness, Tony Doyle and his Wheels of Steel. There you go. Out front, putting the hurt on it, is of course Dalen, Kenny De Kettler and Heinz van Hoek. Goodness me, I saw the Communards live, you know, a few years ago. And
I bet you did.
It wasn't a gig I was looking forward to, but it was absolutely fantastic. There you go.
What was the after party like?
Brilliant.
But so one thing I must say, that Calvin, the music really can make a difference to the riders. So they hear some inspirational stuff that could be the driving force for them to dig that little bit deeper, to get out their suitcase full of courage and to drive even that little bit more.
Oh dear! Oh, you've had some lines tonight. Taking the right line through all of the curves right now. They seem to have sorted out their differences and they're delivering. Team 8 and indeed team number 3 buried the hatchet, not in each other, and they have made it back on here, which is great.
Good move there, and there's a bit of lull there in the string of riders at the front, so they've got their lap, now need to recover, and let's see who's going to be the next team to attack. It could well be team number one, and you could see team number seven, they're pinned to their tails. I think team number one will be attacking within the next few laps.
Do you?
I certainly do.
I think it'll be Stoppler and Harvick. There we are.
There
and
go.
It's not, it's Zeiss.
Now, whether they've got enough power there between them to get this lap, they're having to dig very, very deep there.
Well, Hockman and Hecky from the We Publish Boys, team number 12 in the green here. They've gone off with Zeiss, which is team 10, Wes Crader and Nolan Hoffman in the silver jerseys. And they were part of the initial breakaway that tried to do it and weren't allowed to do so. And Tracks it is, Kaspers and Van Zyl, who are on heartbreaking duties out front. And guess what? The arms are flicking out from AA Drink, team number five. Stoppler and Harvick have got themselves to the nose. Will it be they? Let's have a look. Pace up, and it is Barretti with Lapita and Crader.
No, they don't want these two to get away. So well, they come back together now. Just wait. Let's see how drawn out the string of riders are.
Well, Lampert and Crater started the night as leaders, and this nullifying of the attacks and then the counter punching and the response from the leading teams is spreading the field out, and we're not going to have a pack at all. This is going to get to be a very select bunch, and we're going to see more and more of this as these 6 days progress.
Well, most definitely, but now, yes, it's all coming back together. Rise at the front, are easing back. Lampetard's not driving anymore, but watch it, here's number one. Are they going to go on the attack?
Yes, they are, and dragging through is Marcus and Barco, team seven, the Braden Ord in the red. They've gone, hoping to join onto them, but left it a bit too late. Boskamp and Hasselmann, team number nine. They have bridged over, though. Now, big check there from Barretti. That's the orange jersey of Lampeter and Crader. They had a look. Shall we? Shan't we? Do we want to? Do they want to put in the effort? That's the question, and it's being left to Dalen and De Kettler and Van Hoek to do the driving on. Here we are, just about to pick it up. It's Kenny De Kettler. He knows what he's got to do here. He's got to do a lot.
Now, is he going to persist, or is he going to swing up the bank and then ease it? And are these three riders going to pull away to gain their lap?
Well, everyone's kind of leaning at the moment on the Dalen boys, and Kenny De Kettler in particular. They've had enough of being beaten up by them, and he's refusing to take the pace. Pulls out and says, no, you guys do it. I'm not going to take this on. Unfortunately, you're going to have to work as well. So he goes high and wide, Kenny, leaves everyone else to sort it out for themselves. If you want to have a part of tonight, then you're going to have to work for it. I'm not going to do it all for you, says Kenny De Kettler. Pim Lichtart and Marcel Katz of the Visa team, though, are out in front. Can they do it? They've got some help here from Team 7 and indeed Team 9, but I don't know whether it's the firepower that they require. And it looks like picking this up and pacing absolutely beautifully are the Americans right now. A big shake of the head a few moments ago from Nolan Hoffman, that he hadn't been allowed to go and have some fun out there and get a lap on everybody. I think he's thinking that maybe as he's five laps down that they're going to have a chance at doing exactly that. Well, thoughts otherwise from the pack. And there are no gifts here, and he's sailing round at the moment, still shaking his head. Meanwhile, we've got three riders who are still putting in a pace, and they're slowly but surely making this, but I think this is going to be this is a great piece of strategy here by Dalen, Kenny De Kettler and Gijs van Hoek, because they're going to let these hang out there for a while. They're putting in some pace, but nothing too serious. They're going to make team number one, the Visa boys, work extremely hard, and then you just watch. Team four are going to go for this again and break their hearts straight away, just as they did before.
I think you're quite right there. I mean, team number one, they've got team number seven. They're a strong team who can really help them. And I think we need Robert Barco really to show himself and to really help drive and close this gap. Now, Barco's going to come in for a change now into the bank and coming into the home straight. Is he going to stay at the front and close this gap?
Well, our trio are about to make it on. I'm sorry, we seem to have lost the foghorn tonight. Which usually announces when they get back on to the end of the pack. Maybe it ran out of steam. Who knows? But they are back on, I can tell you that much. So we have they found it again. There we are. Somebody put the kettle on. So what will be the response of Kenny?
And there's a response straight away by Jens Morris, team number three, but that's not going to pay off. Not going to pay off. I think it's going to come back together again.
Yeah, it is. Jens Morris from Vlasman. But tell you something, team eight, Koopmans have gone for this. And we're seeing a nice handover from Tristan Marguet to Mark Hester, the Dane. Now, he's quality.
He certainly is. One of the most experienced riders here. He's ridden 68 six days. And winner of the 6 day of Copenhagen, very experienced rider, rides for Christina Watches on the road, and 6 day racing is what this man's about. He loves it, very passionate, and very experienced, and he knows just when to make the right moves.
Well, AA Drink have gone for it as well. Is it Stoppler that's on the chase just at the moment? It is indeed. So. There's a nice changeover from Blasman. Morris and Sturtinger working well. The pack at the moment is being marshalled, almost policed, I think, by Kenny De Kettler for Dalen, team number four. Kenny's just coming down now to take the handover from Heis van Hoog. They're working brilliantly together. Kenny's on the march right now and he's putting in the pace, but I think he's doing a good job of making other teams work hard. And I think when we get to the end of this, it's a timed one, this incidentally, at the end of each evening. 45 minutes, we have 25 remaining, so 24 now, the clock's just changed. So we're still not quite halfway, and it's been all hell breaking loose throughout the first half of this one.
It's been non-stop action, and team number five here, they're having to work hard for this lap, but they've got some support, and they desperately need to close this lap. They're on one lap at the moment. We've got three teams on zero, and team number five, they need to come back onto zero to stay in contention.
So that was the Berger order sheet being filled in there, I think. Do with one of those myself. We do have the rather distracting but glorious smells of cooking from inside the track. That looks something a bit more important. Shall I have the duck à l'orange? He was thinking to himself. I don't know what that is in Dutch, but anyway. Meanwhile, back on track, and we are having a ball. Cats, Lichtenstein Cats, Marcus Bartko, Boskamp and Asselman, teams 1, 7 and 9, did make it back on. And as a result, they are the only three teams that are on the lead. And here comes your attack. What did it say? Team 4, they had to go for it. And now they are doing exactly that. They got some allies, excuse me, as well. Watch team four, but look at Barretti working hard and Leif Lampeter doing a fantastic job.
There's too many riders there. It's going to come back together. They're going to have to wait and choose their moment. That much better. You might well see team four and team six linking together and going a little bit later, maybe in the next five laps. I think there's going to be another attack and it could well be four and six together.
I think you're right. And there the Hooter just announcing that we now have more teams on the lead lap. As if by magic, it's teams 1, 3, 7. In fact, six of them in total. 1, 3, 5, 7, 8 and 9 all on the lead lap. The Kettler and Van Hoog, you know, they haven't had it all their own way in this one, have they?
No, not at all. I mean, there's still 22 minutes of racing to go. So still a lot of laps to be won and lost. And you wait for it. I think team number four is going to be the next team to attack.
I think you're absolutely right. But look who's marking them. Pim licked up. Marcel Katz from the Visa boys. That's good strategy by them. They're on the lead lap, the men in white. And they are just going to pace behind team four right now. Sprinter boys have done their job for the night, and that's Jeff Hooland. He's a big unit, is our Jeff. A lot of power on board. And here they come. Oh, and they're stepping up, and it's what you said, Barretti, team number six. Lampeter and Crater came in as leaders this evening. And a fantastic response there from Nolan Hoffman. Where's he getting the pace from? He's gone off. He believes that this is a decisive move, and I think he might be right. Also joining the front, Team 12, Yuri Hoffman coming through and just injecting a little bit of pace himself. Hoffman sailing around as well to join this, what is a trio, or is it a quartet? I think the Telegraph have actually instilled this opening move as well. Just Luke Roberts just dips down. Aaron Gate and Luke Roberts, the Kiwi and the Australian, wanting a part of this now.
It looks like when we get these four teams together, they can share the pacemaking. But I'm not sure if the peloton's going to let that happen. And as we speak, team number four got to the front. They're driving really fast. Are they going to close up?
They have got a massive, massive job on their shoulders now. This is huge, and I don't know whether they have going to have the legs to do it. It's a supreme effort, though, right now from Kenny de Kettler. This is the ultimate drive. Kenny de Kettler, number four, he's going to get back on this quartet, and he has to. He's got absolutely no choice. Well, it was a crucial point of the evening. The big mover was Lampeter and Crader for the men in orange, and he couldn't let that go. He just couldn't let that happen.
No, couldn't let it go, and they didn't hang around. And look, they've closed that gap very, very quickly. So there's now going to be five teams who are well over half a lap, and they're going to get it. But team number four, are they going to go straight on?
Oh, yeah, Gijs van Hoek, look at this, into the lead. He's going to put the hurt on these guys. What's the response from those around them? Lampeter and Crader pick it up, and it is Lampeter, who's the German, that's going to try and stay with him. Fantastic work as well, I've got to say, from Wes Crader, who's staying with them in the silver jersey here. And alongside them is Wojtek Hecky, the Czech, also wants a piece of this. And let's not forget what's happened to the Telegraph boys. Aaron Gate having a fantastic push out there too. Wow, what a dramatic moment that was as they came together.
As they came together, they went straight past there and really put the pressure on team number 10, Hoffman there, and team number 2. But they managed to close the gap, and all of those teams have got that lap together. And what a very impressive, though, by the Belgian boys.
Eight teams on the lead lap, and that was quality. Kenny de Kettler and Gijs van Hoek working absolutely brilliantly. It sounds like we're just talking about them tonight. Believe me, we are not. Pim Lichtart and Marcel Katz has done a fantastic job as well. Lampeter and Crader, the men in orange, outstanding. They were also part of that great break, and they are also back on the lead lap. And in fact, that means that they are our leaders overall, let's not forget, because they started the night a lap ahead, albeit Kettler and Hoek got back at them, but they've also passed through the 100 barrier. 100 points gets you a lap, don't forget, as well as making up the actual laps out there.
18 minutes to go, and we've got eight teams in contention, but no one team is out of it. You've got team number two and team number 10, Gates, Roberts and Crader and Hoffman, just one lap behind. So there's going to be a lot of sorting out will be done by the end of this marathon. 18 minutes and six laps. There's going to be a lot more fireworks before the end of the season. Just you wait and see, Carlton.
Oh, without doubt. 18 laps is a whole rack full of laps when they're only taking, 11 seconds to complete in this huge train we've got here. It's amazing.
It is. I mean, it's been go, go, go. No hanging around whatsoever. They're going to average around 54 kilometres this evening, Madison. So very fast discipline tonight. It's just a slight lull. You see the teams are really watching one another. The main teams in contention are all riding very close to one another. Team number six, team number five on each other's tails. So you've got teams four, five and six riding behind each other there. Watching one another. Wait for the next move.
Well, Blasman just looking at each other and thinking, no, don't fancy it this time. And just taking his turn, Jens Maurice looked a bit tired there. I'm not surprised. It's been a busy old night, hasn't it, as we approach the halfway of the 6 days this evening.
Yeah, but I think looks can be deceptive. I think the longer and harder it is, the more Jens can come to the fore. He's got years of experience, very strong. He's done all those miles, all those tours, all those stage races.
Here we go, here we go, here we go. And look at this. Well, they're going to put the hurt on. Now, just looking at AA Drink, Stoppler and Hardwick, team number five in the green and blue jersey, they're to the fore here. And here we go. Hoffman's Nolan Hoffman's looking great tonight, I must say. The South African having a fantastic time. just bedding in, also looking very lively tonight to Telegraph with Aaron Gate and Luke Roberts in the yellow jersey. But out front it is AA Drink at the moment. It's just pacing everybody, having a look. You just feel that they've got something and they're waiting there. You swing up the track, you have a look at those who are around you, and then you choose when to go, and Blatchman kick it off good and proper, and it's Vince Strutinger that takes it away. Who's going to go? And the big loser there, I've got to tell you, was Pim Ligtdot. But you looked and he swore at himself like, I missed that one, that could have been me. Well, he's resting up and seeing who's going off around him, but right now going off like a bomb, it's Jens Maurice who's gone for this. Now 15 minutes and a little bit more than that left. It's a rolling clock on this one, don't forget, 45 minutes. So they've been running for half an hour so far, and we have eight teams on the lead lap. Time then to reach out and make a difference, and it's been nullified. And it's been nullified because Marcel Katz picked it up and wound in AA Drinks and Blastman, and Blastman have backed into it, and Jens Maurice decides that he's going to keep his powder dry just for a moment. But that's a good test early.
Very good test, and team number one didn't like that at all.
Well, they were shouting.
They've lots of screaming and shouting.
Where are you going? It's not yet. Alliances being formed out there, and we'll see whether those alliances come to much. So far, De Kettler, team number four, and Van Hoek are in a decent place. Lampeter and Kreider likewise. They're also on the lead lap, and so if it stays like this, Lampeter and Kreider will be leading at the end of the night. Obviously points count back and how many you've amassed, but and there he goes. Who else? Oh, this is fantastic. Van Hoek kicks it, and this is the crucial move of the night. Question for you, where are the orange jerseys of Lampeter and Kreider? What is going to happen here? Can De Kettler and Van Hoek make this and make it all the way? That's the master plan, and I think they're going to do this with 14 minutes to go.
Team number one, team number five, they were sleeping there. They should have jumped on that bus. They've missed that, and that could well cost them this Madison by the end of the evening.
And indeed, by the end of the week, we'll reach the halfway point tonight, but the number four team of De Kettler and Van Hoek have gone for this brilliantly so, and it's Van Hoek who's going to hang over to Kenny De Kettler and watch him go. Drive he does. Unbelievable form through the corners. Every single one of them is a beautiful line through. Look how deep and low he is taking this one.
Yeah, I mean, and team number four just sitting on the front, prepared to do all the work on their own. And they're driving and driving, and they're going to have to work really hard to get this lap, but it's going to pay off. Just look at them.
Round the corner they come. We have approaching 12 minutes, and then our final laps, don't forget, to finish us off, and some of them will be finished off here. There will be six laps after the clock goes out, and that happens in just over 12 minutes' time. And here come the response.
Response by Jens Maurice. He doesn't like it that these four teams have got away together. The big, strong, tall Jens is going to bring it back. Look at him. He's driving, he's throwing in Wim Strottinger. And as we say that, those four riders out in front, they're going to come back together again. And so this is going to give a chance for Leif Lampeter and maybe team number five to launch a counter-attack.
Well, team six is Lampeter and Kreider. AA Drinks, team number five, Stoppler and Harvick, orange and green. Will they go for it? The orange team of Beretti, Lampeter and Kreider, they have put an awful lot of effort in there to nullify the drive of Kenny De Kettler and Hannes Van Hoek, and they have succeeded. That was absolutely superb piece of retrieval, and they kick again. Look at this, team four have gone off once more. It's like you think you've got us. Absolutely not.
I mean, you know, all credit to them. You've got teams spread all over the track there. You've got like four or five different groups there, and teams are going to be losing laps out the back because they can't stay in the wheel.
You're absolutely right. Beretti in the orange, Vlasman in the multicoloured yellow, red and green, and AA Drink, they're trying to get some back here, but the men in orange, Lampeter and Kreider, are on policing duties, and there's nothing they can do about it by the looks of things, because the pace that's being set out there at the moment is absolutely outstanding. There are riders all over the field. You can't see where the front and the back of the pack is right now. goodness help the commissars. But I tell you something, one thing is for sure, and that is that Kenny De Kettler and Heath Van Hoek are having a fantastic time of things. But the Beretti boys in orange, Lapperton and Crane, who started off leading this evening, they have nullified that drive away.
They nullified it, and Jens Morris, he really set the cat amongst the pigeons. He didn't want that group of four riders to go. And I think you might well see the Beretti boys now. Are they going to make that counter-attack? There's a little bit of a lull now. We're going to see one of those top teams. They're going to be striking out very, very soon, any second now, Carlton. What's going to happen?
I tell you, Team 6 Beretti in the orange are going to go for it, and Pim Lichtart and Fieser are going to join them. Here we are. Lichtart's got a bit of pace. He's just behind Blasman right now. Team Blasman, team number 3 in the multicoloured jersey. Round they come, and it is indeed Beretti and Lampeter and Crater that go for this one. The men in orange who started the day leading, they want to lead at the end of the night, at the midway point of the 6 days, and this is a brave lone push.
Definitely a brave lone push. They're going to have to work really, really hard for this. They're out there on their own. We've only got 10 minutes plus 6 laps to go. It's been non-stop action, all of the Madison, so there could be a lot of tired legs there, but they're totally committed. They've got to make this count. They don't want to be brought back.
They don't want to be brought back, but bringing them back right now is Nick Stoppler, the boss man out there for Iron Drink. And he's pushing everybody on. He's got to. But look who's just behind Glassman. It is Visa. It is Lichtart. It is Katz. And they're going for the men in white. Joining them, the 17, Barry Marcus and Rob Bartko. This is fantastic racing.
I mean, fantastic racing. And again, it's Jens Morris on the front. He doesn't want teams going away without him, does he?
He doesn't. He likes company. Here we go. Lovely slingshot into the corner from AA Drink. Meetech, team number 9, also having fantastic fun out there. We're lapping this up, and hope you are at home too. Live streaming on the web here from Amsterdam, and this the opening of the 6 day winter season. And just look at team number 5, they're trying to control things, and they're doing a fantastic job of it. Problem is, there's some real talent out here, and you just can't pick it. It's all over the track when it wants to be. There's attacks, counter-attacks, real tactics playing a hand. Next up, big throw. Now, can the men in pink go for it once more? Do they want to? That's the question.
I mean, I think they want to, but they won't go this time. I think you might well see team number 1 making the next attack, and that might take Robert Bartko with them.
Team 8 here, the Koopmans boys, Tristan Margay, the Swiss, and the big Dane, Mark Hester, clearly capable as well. And here we go, and oh, it had to be they, didn't it? There it is, Pim Lichtart from Visa, off they go. Now, who's going with them? The answer is Team 4. No, it isn't. They're going to let them hang, are they? Have they got nothing left in the tank?
I think they've got plenty left in the tank. I think they might just leave them out there for a while, make them suffer, make them struggle, just hold them out there. That could be very, very demoralising.
That's Marcel Katz that's doing the driving at the moment. He checks underneath his arm to see what's the response, and here it comes right now, picking pace up big time. Is Kenny De Kettler in the number 4 jersey. Lovely swap going on behind him. You know, Hockman and Hecky, the Czech riders in the green here, number 12, team 12, doing a fantastic job. And Barry Marcus and Rob Bartko as well have had a good run. Team 7, they're also on this lead lap.
I mean, tremendous attack there. There's been a lot of damage done. Now, are we going to see the team number 5? Are they going to be the next team to launch an attack? They want this 6 day. They've got to start asserting their authority. They've got to start showing themselves.
They have, and it's actually team number 8 that have gone for this one. Mark Hester and Tristan Margay in the I never know what to call it, sort of dark pink, let's put it that way, in the pink right now. And in fact, in the red, it's Bredenhort, Barry Marcus and Rob Bartko. Yeah, looking for something. What can they get here? Flick of the arm and coming through, sailing through. Great work by Jurgen Hardwick, Nick Stoppler, his teammate for AA Drinks. And this is a good trio up front. Team 1 Visa, also part of this train. What's the response behind them?
Big strong response there by Leif Lampeter and by the Belgian boys. They don't want these three teams to get away to gain that lap.
Yeah, it's Ray Crader for Beretti in the orange jersey who's on duty right now. But look at the kickaway. Oh my goodness, there was A few words exchanged there just momentarily, but you know what's happened? The Visa boys have gone for this. That's Pim Lichtart, drifts up the track and just lets in Lepeter with under 5 minutes to go. This is fantastic. As soon as the clock's out, then we have our six laps until the end, don't forget. 45 minutes plus six. The clock notoriously sticky towards the end for some strange reason.
I think the jury may be having fun with the riders at certain times. These three guys are out in front, but team number six, team number four, they don't want to give that lap away. They're going to make them work really, really hard. There's no presents, no gifts given in six-day racing. You have to work, sweat for every lap that you get, every point that you gain.
Well, Lichtart and Kautz are having a fantastic time right now in the white jersey of the Visa team. They have some firepower with them. It's Brendan or Barry Marcus and Rob Barco. They're also on the lead lap, let's not forget. So this is a big, big moment for them. And if they can get back on the field, and crucially on team number six in the orange and team number four in the pink, who are leading the charge at the moment, if they can get back on the coattails, then this is fantastic, because it tees it up for an even closer run to the second half of these glorious 6 days. It's fantastic. So many swings and roundabouts. The ebb and flow of this racing is amazing. And indeed, they are playing games with us as far as the clock's concerned. It's been stuck on four now for 2 minutes. I've been timing it.
You've got team seven, team five, team number one there, out gaining a half a lap advantage. But the team who's leading the chase from the string of the riders is team number six, Life Lampetar and Ray Crader. But watch team number four having an easy ride. They're just sitting there letting team number six do all the work. So are they going to be the team that's going to launch the counter-attack if this trio out in front, they gain that lap?
They're going to have allies. They're going to have allies. And it's going to be team four and team six that build the drive back. Of course they are. Why should they let this slip from their grip? They'd like a two-way battle later on these coming 3 days that still remain of these magnificent 6 days of Amsterdam. And indeed it is that pairing that formed the chase right now. There's your trio, but on the other side of the track it is the men in orange and it is the men in pink that are leading the close down. And 3 minutes, it says, two now, and in fact they seem to have found their clock fingers once again. 2 minutes remain. You start counting it down, and then we'll have six flying laps to finish us off for this evening. I think I might be finished off as well. It's been amazing.
I mean, are they going to have enough time? You've got to wonder, got to question whether they've got enough time to gain that lap. They have to really, really work hard. Team number six doing a tremendous job on the front of the peloton. Are we going to see team number four now go to the front and bring it back, that threesome?
Uh-huh. Well, I tell you, they're only a quarter of a lap down. They're going to make it back on unless there's a big, big response from teams four and six. And as we say it, they put it on. They put on the hurt right now, and they can't get back. But there's an extra drive going in from Pim Lichtart here. The crowd know it. They rise and try and encourage him on. Pim for Visa is trying to make it back on. I think he's going to make this. It may well be at the very, very death, though. The clock should have clicked down to 1 minute to go. It's holding at 2 minutes, and it finally moves. It is dodgy on that. They need to give it a kick. Here we go. Giving it a kick at the back is Lichtart. He's just about to get on the back of the pack, and that is superb. He's put a lap on everybody, and I think they might even find the hooter as if to announce it. That was quality. That's the way it's going to stay, and there is the Lichtart hooter. I think we're allowed to say that. Teams 1 and 5 and 7 have made it back onto the train, and now we will count ourselves out. We have around 20 seconds to go before those final laps begin, and then the joy of it. The end of the day for these guys. What a night we've had.
Oh, what a night, but what a hard, tough lap that was. That's a really, really fight for that. So that could well end up, they could feel that in the leg for a long, long time. They're going to need that massage tonight, Carl, not just yourself.
Certainly. They haven't called up the laps just yet, so we'll work on the bell when that finally comes. But it's too late now to make up a lap. They've set the lap clock and they'll count it down from now. So they have been kind of playing with the field. And here we are, they announced the six laps to go right now. Here we are. They start counting down from this point. There's no way you're going to make an escape right now, but it's going to be about the sprint for the line. Oh, and look what's happening. Pim Lickdown comes to the fore. He not only wants the lap, he wants points as well.
He wants the lap, he wants the points, but I don't think team number seven are going to let that happen. Let's see what Robert Farko can do about this.
Well, it is in fact Marcel Kaltz that's on the nose right now. He'll hand over to Pim, his teammate. It's been a joy to see the Beezer boys so motivated, and everyone is exhausted. Look at this, who's got something left? Team number eight is the answer, and they go on a very late attack to try and hoover up the points here. Three laps to go of this evening's proceedings, two more, I beg your pardon. You'll be hearing the bell fairly shortly this evening, drawing to a close and drawing to a dramatic climax. And here we are, go out with a bang, why don't you? Slingshotting their way in. AA Drinks also want more points from tonight, and this is the last chance for the evening. It'll be the bell they take as they cross the line this time by. Who's it going to be? Team number eight it is that go for it. Here comes the bush. Oh, and AA Drinks line it up, and so does Visa and Pim Lickdown. It's there. Marcel Kaltz is going to come to the line. Kaltz on the front. Oh, brilliant work by them. What a night it turned out to be. Fabulous performance by team number one. I think that was the outstanding performance of the evening.
It certainly was. I mean, that's got to be the fastest and fiercest marathon we've had so far, and some great racing. All credit to all of the 13 teams on the track there. Superb display of professional marathon riding. 6 day racing at its best there, Carl.
Absolutely unbelievable. Lickdown Kautz, we salute you. That was amazing. They and Team 5, Stoffler and Arvik with Marcus and Bartko, Team 7, all finishing on the lead lap. Morrison Struttinger leading home a flotilla that included Team 4, De Ketelen van Hoek, Lampeter and Crater, Team number 6. Hester and Margay, Team 8, finishing 7th ahead of Boskamp, Crater, Hoffman and the rest. Amazing, amazing night. And Team 1, Visa, well, that was their passport to glory, I think.
And great to see Marcus and Bartko being up amongst the leaders there, finishing on no laps. And Bartko, of course, has won here three times previously. Been quiet the first couple of days. Now, have we seen him start to show himself, and is he going to get better as the race goes on?
Lickdown Kautz then taking the 20 points here. It's going to be crucial by the end of the week, because these laps are coming and going. They're ebbing and flowing. Fantastic. Get yourself ready for the flowers and the kisses, boys. He's looking for his teammate. He'll take a wipe down in the meantime. Marcel Kautz, the German, being joined by Pim Lickdart. Absolutely superb performance by the men in white from the Visa team tonight. They have just been a joy to watch.
Fantastic. I mean, they worked really, really hard for that, but they certainly deserve that win. They deserve the flowers. They deserve the kisses.
Can't get enough of those. Unless you've got hay for it. What a night. Wow, wow, wow.
It's going to be interesting how those points and those laps are going to affect the overall classification. I see that there's a lot of discussion going on amongst the commissaires and amongst the officials there.
So we wait for our final ranking, but one thing is for sure, the last marathon of the night was just an absolute beauty. Timed at 45 minutes plus 6, I think they actually raced a bit longer than that. I'd love to know what the lap count was for that one, because I think we had so, so many through the night. Confirmation of the final result of the marathon. We're just waiting for our overall classification now.
And I think in those 45 minutes plus 6 laps, they covered a great distance.
There it is. Stoppler and Harvick did the job. Points amassed pay huge dividends. And there it is. AA Drink boys have made it to the top of the standings. That was their avowed intent, and they've delivered. Lampeter and Crater, Team 6, the men in orange in second place ahead of Lickdart and Kautz. Big losers to Kettler and Van Hoek. A lap down. Look at their points tally. They'll be the first to hit 200, maybe. Stoppler and Harvick will be out to stop them. What a night.
What a fantastic night. We've got the AA boys taking the lead from team number five. But there's not much to choose at all between those top six teams. Very close in ability. So we're going to see three great more evenings of racing.
Absolutely unbelievable. I'm hoping that we can speak with our winners and indeed our leaders. Let's head downstairs where Gregor is waiting to speak to the great and the good and the goodly great.
And Pim Lidgaard, the winners of the final Madison. How hard was it to get that final lap, Marcel?
Yeah, it was a hard fight. We attacked one attack of the last attack, and yeah, our legs felt not so good. But if the other team started the attack, I followed the team, and I think it was a good group. Yeah, and you saw it. We take the lap. And in the last sprint, I was a fast man.
Pim, how important was it to get the final lap back for the overall?
It's very important. We're now back at zero, and we're back in the race. And now the last 3 days are coming. We feel we're getting stronger every day, and now we can take up the fight for the win.
You're encouraged by the home fans?
Yeah, of course. It's close to my birth town, and I love the racing here.
And Marcel, you get flowers every time. What do you do with the flowers at night?
Tonight I gave it my girlfriend. She was coming from Germany. Yeah. And she's always for me here.
Yeah. All right, thanks guys. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Great to talk to the winners of the last run today, but we are just waiting to get hold of Stoppler and Arvik, the AA Drinks boys. Also going to speak to us in just a few moments' time, and not surprised, strategy well executed. They're just circulating around the track. They had their fun, and they talked the talk, and they absolutely delivered.
They certainly did, yes. I mean, they've got plenty to say for themselves, but these young riders are showing that they're going to be a team to be reckoned with, Joe. They're not going to give it away lightly. I think we've got three fantastic nights of racing ahead of us. And I think there's going to be a lot to be decided, and I think we're going to see that lead changing every night.
I think you're absolutely right. What's absolutely fantastic, we had De Ketelaer and Van Hoek leading up to day one. Lampert and Kreider leading on day two. Now in Scotland and Harvick, we've got a real ding-dong battle going on here. It's been a joy. Let's go back down because Gregor is just about to talk to one of our glorious leaders here.
Hey, we're here with Stoppler and Yuri Havik. Guys, congratulations. How hard was it to get that final lap there in the end?
Really hard. We gave everything.
It was attack, 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 the whole final Madison. Can you just walk us through what was going on out there?
Yeah, it's what you say, attack, 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 but also chasing, chasing, chasing. And that makes it hard that you go in the attack and you think I'm getting a lap, but you don't.
The Belgians were aggressive tonight. You guys had to watch them carefully for the overall?
Yeah, they are very strong, and they are now one lap back, but they are strong.
And how do you guys celebrate tonight? Do you go to bed early? Do you read each other bedtime stories?
I just eat as much as I can, and then I go flat immediately.
Congratulations, guys.
There we are, go flat. I think he means flat out on his back. Let the body recover. We'll let our minds recover. What a joyous night we've had. Stoppler and Harvick are our leaders. Don't forget, we have day four tomorrow of the six. We'll be here every night and hope you will be too. My name's Carlton Kirby. From me, and indeed from Tony Doyle, MBE, it's a fond farewell. That's how they stack up. How will it stack up tomorrow? You'll have to tune in once again and find out. Bye-bye.
What inspires Giant to push the boundaries of bicycle technology? It's simple, to make you faster. We became the world's number one cycling brand by delivering unrivaled craftsmanship, innovation, and inspiration to every ride. We create bikes that inspire you to push your own boundaries. We innovate to make you faster.
This program was presented by Giant Bicycles, Tux, and Island 200.